All right, everybody, thank you. January 4th, 2019, welcome live from the Troy Lee Design Saloon. It's the Whiskey Throttle Show. Thanks for coming. All right. Yes, thank you. Our first live show. I want to say thanks to everyone that showed up today. Your tickets go to Road to Recovery. All that money, it's helping injured riders. So I just want to say thank you. We do want to try to give back and do some good here. And between Weston Pike and all these other guys that get hurt out there in the line of battle, we want to be able to give back. So thanks to Road to Recovery for coming and helping the guys at the door. And all you guys, thank you very much. We have got 7-time champion Ricky Johnson here tonight. Who's excited about that? I don't know if you know this, but he is the Justin Bieber of motocross. So we're very excited. We've got the Method Race Wheels front end chatter segment. Of course, Power Dots bringing you Ricky Johnson tonight. Decal Works bringing us our last call segment. And then we've got the Four Wheel Parts Q&A Get At Me segment. Some questions sent in from folks and fans on Twitter and Instagram. Let me introduce you to my partner, Grant Langston. He is a 6-time champion, but really he's only going to take 3 because I've got 2 of his. I took the West Coast 250 title in Supermoto. And our producer, Donnie Bales, folks, East Coast 250 Supercross champion.
I took one of GL's championships. Yeah. I don't think he needs them all.
Yeah, give it up for Grant Lakes River. Just sharing his championships. Yeah. God, so nice of you.
Redistribution. Oh, there we go.
Yeah, that's how we like it. It's the way of the future. Just share everything, right? Big thank you to Troy Lee Designs for just believing in this show, really backing us, allowing us to build this amazing saloon here in their back building. And just being rad all the time. I mean, Troy's for a long time has been a friend of mine, and I've just loved this guy's vision, his creativity, and his love of vodka, right? I mean, at the end of the day. Dunlop Tire is another big supporter of the show, and you know, you'll hear me rant a lot about supporting the people that support the sport, and there is not another tire company that provides a truck every single weekend at every single supercross and motocross race. They are out there supporting the factory teams, developing tires, working with them just day in and day out, supporting amateur racing, developing tires all year long. There's not another company that does it. Dunlop's been committed since the very beginning. So even if all tires were created equal, which they're not, support the people that support the sport. Those guys do. So Brock Glover is here tonight. I want to thank him and thank Dunlop Tires for really getting behind us. All right, tonight we are giving away a free Power Dot unit to a live member of the audience here, somebody who bought a ticket. So we're going to differentiate. We know there's some VIPs in here. And we got a little deal we're going to do to give it away. We'll get into that later. Also, someone here tonight is going to win a set of Method race wheels. That's a pretty high ticket item. So,
depending what vehicle you drive.
Yeah, that's a big deal. So there's going to be a contest for that later. It may or may not involve chugging 805 beer at a rapid rate of speed.
Hey, can I get my name in on that? Get those wheels?
Donnie, you're disqualified.
Immediately. You're on the employee list, so you're out.
That's right.
Well, I thought I'd ask.
All right. Let's jump right into our Method Race Wheels front-end chatter. If you're not familiar with Method Race Wheels, we're going to get you there eventually, all right? The toughest, fastest, lightest wheels in all types of off-road racing, whether it's truck racing, Baja, UTVs, these guys have it. Sprinter vans, their stuff is rad. Check them out, Method Race Wheels. Who here, I want to just bring something else up because this is something these guys brought to my attention and said they wanted to do, and I am psyched out of my mind. Who here knows about Dirtfish Rally Driving School? Anybody? Anybody familiar with that? This is the premier... Ricky Johnson knows. He's the only one in the audience. Awesome. Dirtfish Rally Driving School is like the premier rally driving course. It's in the Pacific Northwest, winds through the trees, this incredible facility. They've got vehicles. Method Race Wheels is one of their partners. And they are going to give somebody a free trip to the Dirtfish Rally Driving School with Grant and I. You're going to go
say,
through the school with us.
They need babysitters.
Yes.
We have to go and show them.
So we will join you on that trip. All of us are going to learn to have drive rally cars.
Maybe we drag RJ along.
We're going to be, stay tuned to our Instagram page or our web page. We're going to announce the call to action, how you go about getting signed up for that contest, but that's coming up. We're going to give away that seat this spring, and then we're going to do another one at the end of the summer. So one for the Supercross season and one for the Nationals. You are going to want to sign up for that. I promise you.
Yeah. That looks really awesome.
Bucket list, right?
I've watched that before, and it's certainly something that I am stoked to maybe have an opportunity to go and do with you guys.
I know. All right. So our Method Race Wheels front-end chatter, we got a couple topics we're going to cover tonight. GL, I want to start with this. Ricky Carmichael is going to the NBC broadcast team for the Supercross series. What are your thoughts?
Well, you know, I think when people saw the change in TV networks, even people thought that maybe I would be in that seat. But at the end of the day, MX Sports, which run the outdoors and Felt that run Supercross, have always wanted to be distinctly different. And I think they made that clear, and I get it from a business standpoint. It makes a lot of sense. I know some people were maybe a little shocked or disappointed that Jeff's not back. I think it's just one of those things. He's been there so long, you know, you become part of the furniture and it's something different. But Ricky's done TV before. He's also obviously a five-time Supercross champion. So I think for that side of it, I think Ricky's probably the best man for the job right now. And obviously Ralph's been sort of the staple guy there for a long time.
It's funny because you can't seem to make people happy. You go on shit forums or whatever, and I mean, people are bashing Ralph and Jeff. Oh, you know, this and that.
They get rid of Jeff.
And now,
like that. Yeah.
Now they're like, where's Jeff? Oh, I can't believe they got rid of Eric. So I don't think you can make people happy here. And another thing that I want to just bring up is, and David Bailey told me this when he was on the team and then he got let go. He said, that's a very cutthroat industry. And for no particular reason, they just want to make a change. They'll make a change and you're gone. And so when I did the Nationals one summer in 06, I did the color commentary. And he said that to me. He goes, if you want to go down that road, you know, just here's a heads up. There's absolutely no loyalty. It's worse than the racing industry. They'll just make a change because they feel like it. And what they told Jeff was, hey, we want to distinguish ourselves from the Nationals so we don't look like them, or we want to make a change from Fox, rather, sorry. And he said, yeah, but I'm the only guy you got rid of. You still have Ralph. You know, you still have Blair. So anyway, I think that's a tough one, man.
I mean, we know how it goes. I mean, even RJ, who's here tonight, he's been involved in TV and, you know, things just happen, shake, and move. And I think with Ricky, what it is he's a recently retired champion, more current than Emig. And I think from the TV's point of view, they want someone that's currently freshly retired, if that makes sense, or someone that's relevant, that can speak well and do all those things. And I know they explored avenues like Villopoto, Dungy, even Wyndham, people like that. And I think some of those guys basically said, we don't know if we're really cut out to be that person right now.
Yeah, that's a tough job. It's not easy to do. You know.
I do know.
You do know.
I have an idea that it can be very tough. And no matter what you say, you're not going to please everyone, like you said. Whether you think you've got the dream team in there, you'll please maybe majority, but there's always going to be the people that don't get your humor, don't like your dumb jokes, whatever. I get it. Get over it.
So you think Ricky will do a good job?
I think with Ricky doing TV, I think he's comfortable, and I think we've seen what we know of Ricky, and I think Ricky will do a good job. Yeah, I think he'll fit in. I don't think it's a big, oh, how's this guy going to do? He's a noob. You know, he's got experience. I think he'll be just fine.
I think, here, my opinion is this. I wasn't blown out of the water with the stuff Ricky did last year, but if there's one thing we know about RC, he is a hard worker. And so if he's committed to this, he's going to work his ass off to be the best color commentator he can be. So.
And he's good buddies with Fro, you know, with Emig. So they I'm sure they're going to be able to bounce off each other and theoretically help each other in order for Ricky to get through maybe some trial and error period.
Yeah. Quick side note, I've been drinking Red Bull and vodkas all night, and now I'm drinking coffee thanks to my wife Amber, wherever she is. And I am so tweaked right now, I am seeing noises. So if I seem a little off, that's going to be the reason why, folks. Question two here. The Method Race Wheels front end chatter. We might have a mudder. What do you think about mud races in Supercross?
Great equalizer. I mean, you know, that phrase gets thrown out there quite a lot, but I think it's really true. I mean, you know, in 2005, I remember a true mudder, and everyone was talking about Reed, Stewart, and Carmichael, and they went on the podium. You know, and it came down to the weather was the great equalizer. The rain is getting pushed further and further back, and I think what makes this even more interesting is it may just start downpouring right when the main event starts. So now it comes back to, do you anticipate the weather? Have you made changes? Have you got any background? Then some guys are like, oh, I grew up in Michigan. I'm used to this. Some guys from South Africa going, oh, my God, I'm screwed. Like, this is not what I anticipated. So it really is, but we've always seen it before. Good start really helps these sort of events start off on the right foot.
Yeah. Supercross, the one thing about a muddy Supercross race is that you don't practice Supercross in the mud ever. If it's raining or they overwater a motocross track, you still go out and you ride. When it's muddy, you don't ride your Supercross track. It's expensive to fix it. It's sketchy. It's dangerous. And so that makes it tough when it's race day and you've got to go fast.
It's that risk-reward factor. Like you said, a lot of riders will sort of steer away from that those conditions because they don't want to put themselves in the element or the potential to get injured.
Yeah.
And then, like you said, you throw something like this in, well, then what happens? Now they're not used to it. They could get injured, and someone's bike's going to break, and someone's going to be heartbroken tomorrow. I'll tell you that much.
Yeah. Well, the mechanics for sure if it's muddy.
Well, they'll all be heartbroken.
Those poor bikes.
Yeah.
Just wrecked. All right, listen, let's get into our Ricky Johnson interview. Rick, let's bring you up, damn it. Come on up here.
Round of applause. Legend.
Seven-time champion Ricky Johnson. He's brought to you by PowerDot. As I mentioned, if you want to win a free PowerDot, we'll be giving one away every single month starting tonight. That's going to happen right here in the live audience. They won't always be at the live shows. But for your chance to win, go to powerdot.com/whiskeythrottle. And enter the contest. You don't have to write an essay. We don't need nudes. We don't need anything else crazy. Just some basic information. You'll be entered.
We'll nudes pick a are name. Optional.
Nudes optional. Are optional. You can send those to, what is it, GL at the Whiskey's Office?
Let me delete that one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My bad.
We'll draw our winner next month. But, Rick, thank you for joining us tonight.
Awesome, man. I'm here. Come on, you guys.
Let's make some noise.
Let's get a round of applause.
Come on, man.
It's a live show. We're supposed to have some fun. Yeah. You're not in a history exam. I want to thank Troy Lee and also Brock Glover for coming out. Brock, thanks for supplying the posters. That was awesome. Great moment in my life, 1987 Unadilla, when America won the Trophy to Nations.
America! For those of you who are not here, Dunlop, Brock brought a bunch of the Dunlop posters of Ricky at the 87 Motocross Donations in the Mud.
Yes.
Where you kick some ass.
Yes. And when you guys are talking about, I'm going to go back to your Ricky Carmichael fro thing. If you think Jeff Emick is going to throw him a bone, you guys are high as a kite. All right? For one, the guy just got fired, and now he's going to help his replacement, friends or not. It's like getting a factory ride stolen from you. Hey, could you give me a couple training lessons, you know? So I don't know how much he's going to...
Could you help me with starts?
Yeah, exactly. Could you help me out there? But I do want to agree with you guys as far as RC. He's a big game player. And so, is the network going to like his style? Are they going to like the twang of his voice, what he's going to do? And he really doesn't need to work on that. He doesn't need to be the voice. And Emig, Emig went from a guy that stuttered to a guy that was doing TV shows, and God bless him, he did an awesome job. Round of applause for Jeff Emig for overcoming that.
Yeah, listen.
That's huge.
That on itself, that is like me playing the NBA.
Exactly. I mean,
it's
maybe
tough.
Not that bad.
Oh, but yeah, I was gonna say you're borderline midget, so like he could at least speak. You battled a running pace.
But that's the thing though. If you watch Dale Jr. now there, and I think what you said about they want a more relevant guy that's newer, fresher, and stuff like that. And nothing against them. Like they're making a change and they're gonna do something. And if they like what Ricky produces, and Ricky just needs to be Ricky and not try to be anything, not try to be the voice. That's Ralph's job. He just needs to hammer the facts. And I hate that I'm drawing short on the other kid's name that's working there.
Daniel Blair.
I love that guy.
Yeah, he's doing a great job.
And honestly, I think that it would, and Ricky wants that right seat, the color commentary, but I think doing some switch up, putting him down below with those nuggets of information of what riders are really thinking, all the different stuff, because Ricky might drown him out. You know what I mean? Because he has so much knowledge. But so you got. So anyways, I think it's going to be interesting.
I think you're exactly right. I obviously, I'm not making decisions over there at NBC, but Daniel Blair is very articulate. Yep. He's very well spoken. He'd be the guy that I'd put in that seat next to Ralph and get Ricky on the track talking about, hey, here's what's going on at the track. Here's what the guys are thinking. Yep. Give us some real-life stuff that Ricky obviously knows about.
We should produce the Supercross show.
Somebody at NBC, give me a call.
It's going to be Whiskey Johnson Supercross show. Anyhow, thanks for having me. I'm stoked to be here following a man like Roger DeCoster and to be on the podium, so to speak, for the Whiskey Throttle show. So thank you for having me.
Oh, man. Listen, I don't know if you followed the Racer X top greatest 100, greatest motocrossers of all time, but you were in the top three.
Yeah, they missed it by a couple, but yeah, it was pretty good.
They were close. All right, give them some credit. Listen, I want to start at the beginning with you, Rick. I mean, tell me, I know your dad was into dirt bikes. Tell me how you got started.
So getting started, I was a little kid in El Cajon. My dad was a tradesman, a painter, and he saw this mini bike, and he rode Harleys and Triumphs and things like that, and also raced go-karts. And so I was, ironically, I got a picture of my mom pregnant, because they didn't know back then, out of Hamul, go-kart track with a beer next to like a nitro can.
Well, that explains a lot.
Smoking a cigarette. Thank you,
making
Mom.
Sense.
Made me who I am. But so growing up, we would go to the desert and stuff like that. And so my dad got me started on this mini bike. This picture that you're seeing is me on my sister's 100. As a matter of fact, my dad modified that bike for Brock Glover to race back in the day. So Brock has an interesting story about that Yamaha 100 way back when. But yeah, we would go out to the desert and stuff and ride, had a good time. And then I had a situation where I was coming around one of the campers. Another kid was coming around another way. We hit. I went flying over the bars and all the different stuff. And my dad was like, I want to go to a place where they're going in the same direction. So we went out to a place called Four Corners, which is the precursor to Barona Oaks, and got my ass kicked. Smoked, last place, but I loved it. I loved the fear of going to the race. I had my riding gear on, my helmet on, sitting in the truck. And then this picture's out at Barona Oaks after they closed Four Corners. And if you can see, it says a 60. So back then, you had a XR80, you'd sleeve it down and make it a 60. And that's flying Mike Brown on the... It wasn't a factory Indian, but he was a factory Indian rider. I was ahead of him at the time. But yeah, so a product of Southern California, riding all the time.
That's awesome. I love the leathers too, like the traditional leathers. Were they Lancer leathers?
No, they were just some hippie leathers. But if you notice, no gloves. I was kind of weird about gloves.
Oh, yeah, notice it now.
You couldn't find gloves small enough for kids to wear.
And I remember hearing that.
I didn't want to wear garden gloves because it made the grips too big. And then, and what was crazy is my dad had different handlebars on all three classes of bikes. My stock modified, my 60. I had handlebars here, here, and here. I don't know why it took me so long to get comfortable, but that's just the way we did it.
So you guys just got into it, started with your amateur racing that way, and it just progressed?
Yeah, it was something to do. You know, my sister was doing her thing. She was 4 years older than me. She raced a little bit, but then she kind of got the boy thing going on in junior high and stuff. And she raced, and she was actually pretty good. But she just, I remember she came out when we got YZ80Bs and... when I say Bs, there was an A and a B. That's how old I am. I think they're like YZ80 double Xs now.
What years were this? Just give me an idea. So
this is 1973, 1974. Actually, no, 1975. I was 10 years old at that time.
Okay.
And so the XRs were the big thing. That's the fuser. That was 8 years old on a 100, and I just decided to let her send it. But yeah, so we would go every week, and I just loved it because we lived in El Cajon. We had a little track in our yard. The Brock would come over, and we had tracks all around.
Was that a Honda?
Yeah, that was a Honda XR75 sleeve down.
And so you said growing up in El Cajon, and you had Brock around. Anyone else that became relative or champions in the future?
Damn, who didn't become relative? We could get Brock up here and
talk.
We
were looking, we were saying, like, El Cajon was that spot for a while. So.
Well, you had Santee, Lakeside, and El Cajon. It's basically the Bermuda Triangle of white trash, right? So it's everything is about horses, trucks, motorcycles, fist fights, and just it was like the place
and
to
weed,
be.
And weed, probably, back then.
Not a lot of weed, not with the racers, but... but it was there. It's been everywhere. But you had Marty Tripes, and then the guy that we both looked up to. He didn't do much motocross. Was a guy named Murray Hoffman, and he was the first like whiz kid, really little short guy that could ride anything. He ended up doing road racing and all different kinds of stuff. And we had Don Vescos, who he ended up had the land speed record, a little Yamaha shop there. And Bill Silverthorne was a guy that raced for Honda, and he was also, you could ride bicycles by his house and stuff when Honda came out and did the Baja 1000. But you had Marty Tripes, Marty Smith, Mike Tripes, Tommy Croft, Brock Glover, Ron Lachine, Scott Burnworth, Brock, help me out here, who else? Dan Schramm, Mike Craig, and the list goes on and on. I mean, we just had so much talent, and there were so many generations of it. But for me, I was very, very blessed to have a neighbor and a friend like Brock. We met him and my sister were in junior high together, and Brock was kicking everyone's ass down at the Speedway 117 on a Kawasaki Green Streak. It was pretty crazy. It was like this enduro bike that his dad put a pipe on it. Did you shift it all down or all up? I think it was four down or four up. But anyways, Brock was killing everybody, and he was this young kid with long blonde hair. My sister had a crush on him. And so my dad hated all the guys from L.A., the Orange County, Jeff Ward, and all these different guys. He goes, I got this guy, because I was racing. I was 10 years old at the time. He goes, I'll build a bike for having whipped their ass. You know. So my dad was a little bit competitive. So he ended up taking that 100 of my sister's, chopped it up, made it a mini 100. And Brock raced it, and we became friends. And so for me, the blessing was that Brock was a little bit older than me. He was racing for DG at the time and doing that kind of stuff. And then he got his Yamaha ride when he was 16. And so I was really young. I was 12 years old. And so I watched what a champion had to do. You know, yeah. He drank this shitty protein powder stuff, and he would try to get me to drink it. I was just like, ah, it's terrible. And,
so things haven't changed.
I'm like, milkshakes. I'm like, sure, my milkshakes. It's chocolate, you know. But and Brock trained so hard. You know, I was down with him in 77. So when he won the 125 championship, we went down to San Antonio, Texas, and I just got in a 125. I was 12 years old at the time, and so I would go out there and haul ass, and then he would catch me and lap me and stuff like that. And then we would go. I'd had a little DG bicycle that he got from DG, and I would ride the bicycle up and down, you know, in San Antonio with the humidity, and he would run and stuff like that until I thought I got him disqualified because I wasn't 16, and the official from AMA took my pass, and I'm like, I'm Brock Glover's little brother. He goes, well, he's getting disqualified. I'm like, holy shit, I just got my friend disqualified. So, yeah, so I had guys like him and Marty Smith and Croft and Tripes and stuff like that that had done it.
Yeah, I've heard you say that Brock was a really big influence on you and a really good mentor. That had a big influence on your career, huh?
Yeah, oh, absolutely, because he had success. You know, Brock had the right amount to me, and I'm not just, you know, saying it because he's here, because it's true. You know, when you have – Brock had talent, but he had the work ethic, you know, back then and the hours that he would put. And so every time I would –
Which was a rare combination when you look at history.
Exactly. Well, but he grew up in a really tough era between him and Hannah and Pierre Karsmaker just came to Yamaha, so yep. The training thing was really wicked, man. These guys would be down in Florida, a place called the Orlando Sports Stadium, sand whoops this big, and they'd go out and do motos, just hauling ass. Then when they were done, they would put on the running shoes and run around the track and stuff. So I saw this, and I'm like, I got to eat this really shitty food, and I got to run a lot, and I got to be this guy. But I also saw the side of Brock when he had buggies and boats, and he had fun, but it was clean fun. It wasn't. Yeah. He didn't just go nuts at the end of the year and go to Vegas crazy. He would go down to the river and go skiing, do that kind of stuff, or then he'd go to the desert and ride three-wheelers and stuff. So it was a very, very positive for me, and then it would just, like I said, I knew what I had to do.
Yeah, well, it laid the groundwork for you. And I see that, you know, that same thing in a lot of people. Carmichael had Johnny O'Mara step in, and even though he was retired for a while at that point, he really showed him, hey, this is what you need to do.
Yeah.
I think that that's huge for a lot of guys. And if you don't have that, it's tough. If you don't have somebody to tell you, this is what you need to do, that you trust and you believe, that can make it tough.
I mean, I can relate. When I came from South Africa, when you know, and I was pretty naive, and I thought I trained pretty hard, and that when I went to Europe, I got a ride with Harry Evetts, father to Stefan Evetts. Harry, four-time world champion, Stefan, 10-time. And when I saw what these guys were doing, it blew my mind. I really thought I was a hard worker.
I can't wait to show them my work ethic.
Yeah, exactly.
I want to go back to South Africa.
And it was literally like that. You were like, okay, put your tail between your legs and shut up and just watch and learn.
And do the work.
But it's good to have that because it really was, puts things into perspective, I think.
Yeah. Absolutely. And like Grant said, you know, you had Albie. That sort of paved the way for you. And a lot of times they don't have to tell you things because I know that Brock got sick of me after a while because I was like Stanton was with me, man. What are you doing? Whatever you do, I'm going to do it.
Yeah,
I'm going to
try
to do it 5% better, no matter what. And it was, well, oh, I can't, I'm 10% worse. Now I got to work harder at this and that. So when you have somebody that you are pseudo mentoring or getting mentored from, it sometimes it gets a little edgy.
Yeah, for sure. We've got a neat picture. Oh, here it is.
Yep.
I wanted to ask you about this. So I don't know if you can see this photo from the audience, but you see Johnson on the back of this shirt and Two Hip Junior.
Yep.
Jimmy Johnson, NASCAR champion. These two are buddies.
Yep.
And a lot of people that know him or know that story know that he started out racing motocross and then transitioned into karts and cars. Tell me about your guys' relationship growing up.
So I met, there was a place called Speedway 117 or South Bay Speedway back in the day, and my dad was going down there. And when you sign up early, you got first pick on the gate, and the first pick was good because you could see the guy pull it, and then it was a 180, so you could blow everybody out in the turn. So you always had to get there early. So this van tries to pass us, and my dad's like, bullshit, because he's thinking it's one of the guys in, I think it's 125, or no, I was in the 80 class, is gonna get the spot on us. So they're racing, we get there, and this guy gets out, and he's laughing, and he's got a mustache and blah, blah, and his wife gets out and is pregnant. Come to find out, it's Jimmy Johnson's mom and dad. And Jimmy's grandfather owned a Kawasaki shop in California, in El Cajon. But Gary was a mechanic down in a place called Lucky Yamaha. And so then we got to talking. We became friends. Gary became my mechanic. Jimmy's born. So now I can say, I don't know if I'm proud of it or not, but I did wipe Jimmy Johnson's ass because I had to change his diapers when I was a kid. So I've known Jimmy from actually before he was born. And then they moved to Texas for a little bit when he was a baby. When he came back, I was racing for Yamaha at that time. This is 1983, and I was 18 at the time, and so they didn't have a lot of money and stuff like that, so I was able to get bikes at a good deal. And so we got Jimmy a 60 and an 80, and he was 8 years old, and sort of pseudo-sponsored him and helped him out. And then Jimmy hurt his knee. If you follow his Instagram, he got a ride for R&D, was going fast, hurt his knee, and then they just kind of bagged out of it. But then Jimmy came back and was doing some short course off-road racing, and then I got him a test. And also it was between Brock and Jimmy, actually, for the second seat in the stadium truck. And BFG really liked Jimmy, so they kind of pushed Jimmy into the seat. We became teammates there, and then Jimmy was younger and just kept accelerating and going.
Wow.
Yeah.
He did okay.
He's done all right. He's done okay.
Well, he's obviously done pretty good in his former racing, but talk a little bit about your amateur career. I mean, we all know your professional records, but, even before this time, you know, you said you were moving up.
Well, yeah, and I noticed you had a Mammoth motocross hat on. I mean, yes. What amateur races were you doing? Like, was Ponca around back then?
No, World Mini? Ponca wasn't around. So the World Mini was there. I did that at an early age. It used to be at Indian Dunes. I did the first year, I think it was in 73, or that I did it in 73. It's called the World Muddy Grand Prix, and they canceled it. It was so muddy. It was crazy. Oh. And then we couldn't afford that back then. They didn't have regionals to go to one place. They always just had a national thing, and we couldn't afford to do it, so I was never ranked that high. But I went through the ranks really fast. Like when I was 9 years old, I became expert in the 9 to 11 class at 9. And so then when I turned 12, I was racing 80s, but we couldn't really afford, once again, to go to these different places. So Brock let me ride one of his 125 practice bikes. And I'm like, this thing's bitching. And so we went to Carlsbad and Brock let me race it. And I raced it in the junior class. And I was, you know, in mid-pack because I was a little guy at the time, 12. And my dad, I loved it. He goes, well, we can't afford to have 80s or 125s. So you got to pick what you want to do. And I said, well, I like this because I feel like a man. You know, these big wheels go through the holes better and all the different stuff. And I can, and there's so much more I can do. I feel like I'm tapped out on an 80. So we sold the 80s, bought a 125. Brock gave me a cylinder, a carburetor. He got in trouble for that later. He got found out.
And big no-no.
but that was the greatest thing about it. So that I had somebody that was a national champion and way faster than me to just constantly go out and practice with and stuff like that. So and then I turned pro. I went in 3 months from junior to intermediate to pro because I raced Wednesday night, Saturday, and Sunday. So I'd get all the double points. So I turned pro when I was like the week after my 13th birthday. But I couldn't do nationals. And I had Brock introduced me to the Yamaha people and stuff like that. So I got a support ride.
Okay.
And then they put me on 100 at the time. And I won the 100 national in the intermediate class. It was my last race. Won all but one 100 race. And then they got rid of them. There was nobody to race with. So they put me on a 125. I won the Southern California Championship and did well, and then went into 1981 into the pro ranks and got Rookie of the Year. And I broke my left wrist that year, but I think I got seventh and won the last National Moto of the Year. So I was really.
I think we have a picture of that. Oh, is this it?
Yeah, that's it. That's a Carlsbad Raceway. So that was.
And you were the man at Carlsbad, huh? That was your spot.
I knew that place. Like my lines were cheater lines. I knew so many places because, and what helped me out. Was I went to a Suzuki school back in the day. Does anybody remember that? Suzuki school? There's some old people here.
Was it the Tony D one?
No, not Tony D. It's Mark Blackwell. So Wayne Boyer and Bob Elliott taught the class, but you could go there and ride bikes for a week, and they would train you and do all the different stuff, and you rode at Carlsbad. So you learned where you could ride on the fence and cut corners and do all this crazy stuff and figure out how to ride it in the second motor when it was bone dry. And so after that, I was a different animal there.
Well, that place, too, was if you knew it, you had a huge advantage. Yeah. It was like it would go from greasy to super tacky to hard slick. And you had to really know how to ride it, like you're saying.
Yeah, and that's the thing is Brock knows the Grismers there. I think we've all had a couple verbal confrontations with them at the time, but they didn't take real cherry care of it. They would just turn the sprinklers on Saturday night, and you'd have dust and mud and that. But so if you knew where you could go up on chain link and grab some traction and things like that, and I had all those lines. So yeah. It really wasn't fair against the other guys, but hey. Yeah. I'll take it.
Hey, winning is winning.
Winning is winning.
Everyone's got
W is
know,
a W.
You know, home race is a home race. But, you know, if you get a race at home a lot and you win and you got local knowledge, take it, right?
Well, interesting fact, Mr. Bell, quit talking during my interview. Who was my team manager at that time?
My dad.
And his name is?
Bill Bell.
Bill Bell, that's right. See, a little interesting fact. Mike Bell and, you know, got the boy here.
Scotty Bell.
So we Mike got Tuchel. We got the hole. You got Dora. That's what Bebo calls her, right?
Dora.
Anyway, so yeah, their dad was my team manager, Yamaha. So
I didn't know that.
Things are a lot more connected than we realized, huh?
Exactly. We all had a plan. It's all Southern California guys.
That's cool.
It's such a small industry that way, right? Like, we see that all the time. I didn't know that tonight, but
yeah.
You learn all that kind of stuff.
And Gene was right there with you.
Yep, he was a little bit younger than me. He was
clean air cleaners or do anything, change oil.
Hey, everybody out there listening, don't listen to that heckler in the crowd.
Yeah.
Full of shit.
He can say what he wants. He built the handlebar back here.
That's
that guy,
right.
How rad is that thing? Does anybody give me an amen on that
give
thing?
Give me what?
Ricky, you got to have some good amateur national stories.
Not really. Well, okay. Springfield, Missouri. Went back there.
That didn't take long.
As I'm feeling a Band-Aid on my finger.
Yeah.
So Springfield, Missouri. We go back to national championships, 9-11. I'm set up to do really well. We go back there, and so in the 80 class, you know, dads would play with the fuel a little bit. So my dad found this go-kart guy and it had toluene or this or that. I'm pretty sure it was illegal, but man, it made the bike all last. So I go out in the 80 race, in the stock race, and they had these wood chips, and I get a flat, and I go down, and I crack my cheek and blow my teeth through my lip because I had a cut-off Scott mask because I thought that was really cool. Not right. Cool.
Super
so
cool.
So I sliced my face open, cracked my cheek and that, and then I end up getting dehydrated and sick the next night. So the next morning I'm out there, I'm racing the 80 class, the 80 modified class with my bitch and deal, and it had a plastic gas cap. Well, this gas was so hot, it shrunk my gas cap. So during the middle of the race, boom, I just get soaked with gas.
Geez.
And so now I got this hot race fuel, and I'm like, oh, they don't know what's going on. I'm burning up. I'm red all over the place. I'm in ice chest. So I have to borrow leathers for the 105 race, and so I'm out there, and I'm leading that, and then I get this little rock wedged in there, and I think my bike seizes, and like my dad's like comes up and started to let the clutch out, keep stopping. My dad rolls it backwards. The rock falls off. I get like 10th or something like that, something ridiculous, and it was just terrible. Blew the end of my finger off, cracked my face open. So I wasn't a big fan of those, you know. So I didn't do real well in the amateur thing.
Hey, there was some serious cheating that went on back there, huh? Like, I always got a kick out of this.
Well,
I
mean, it's only cheating when you get caught.
Exactly.
Back then it was called okay. Testing the waters.
Okay, so
they
did,
create rules.
I tested the waters once back at Loretta's. A certain bike on a mini did not have good top end. It had good bottom, no top. So we took the head
gasket off.
We took the head pipe and cut it and shortened it, which gave you more top end. And then we welded it, and we sanded the weld down, and we painted it black. You couldn't tell.
Did anyone ever find out?
No. I didn't win a title, though.
Did you win?
No. I won later, and they got disqualified for
what
another
What pisses you off is when you cheat and you get beat.
Yeah.
Like someone,
yeah.
When someone cheats better than you, that just irks me, man. Yeah. That happened in a stock car race, and I was out there. I had soaked tires. I'm doing this, and I had this Sean Woodside asshole come down from up in L.A. and just going around the outside of me and just smoked me. I'm like, how? I'm cheating. What is he doing? How is he going that fast?
I had a guy.
He doubled down.
Exactly. Yeah.
There was a guy that I grew up racing with on 80s in Phoenix, and his mom was loud and obnoxious, and she'd come over. She came over one time. I know you guys are cheating because we are, and you're beating us.
That's what I'm saying. It pisses you off worse because you're like, well, I thought we were stretching the rules a little bit.
Oh man!
And I know you were a cheating son of a bitch with your dad and your uncle.
Well, you know what's
don't
funny?
Don't even
was,
go there.
What's funny was
we could do a whole show on Grant's cheating stuff.
Well, what's funny was I won a lot as a kid in South Africa. We dominated everything, and we would leave every race with the bike in a cardboard box because we got protested, and they would strip them down, and then they were shocked to actually find that there wasn't anything wrong because half the time we were borrowing bikes from someone else. Same thing. We didn't come from much, but
well, your uncle is an incredible mechanic.
Yeah.
He was my mechanic at the last Supercross I won.
So we did basically what I think was the most with very little resources.
Exactly.
I don't know if it was cheating. I was a kid. So, Dad, if you cheated, don't tell me about it. I don't want to feel guilty
Dad,
one day.
Why is my bike so much louder than everybody else's? It's bothering my ears.
Everyone says my bike sounds great. I just thought it was my riding. Apparently it was fucking illegal.
I'm just twisting
what.
That throttle harder.
All right, I want to talk about the El Cajon Zone. You mentioned the guys involved. I got a little DM slide in from Scott Burnworth.
Yeah.
He said, you got to ask him about the original Supercross after parties in the El Cajon Zone.
Yes.
He said, and I will quote because I wrote it down here, the parties were wild. A house in South Mission with a grotto underneath it that had caves, a jacuzzi, and a dance floor.
Yes. Yes, and that wasn't mine. I had a small shack in El Cajon that I was very proud of, but that was actually Roger Norman, the guy who's owns Score International. Yep. Him and his father were doing pretty well. They were the Strip King Malls, and they started with Roger's Auto Body and stuff like that. Well, they took two condos, and then they had to get it condemned because you couldn't just remodel it. So Roger had this idea. I'll go to Home Depot, call my friends. We're going to have a party. Let them smash the house. They condemned it. Then they dug in. This is on Mission Beach, and Brock has been there. On Mission Beach, they dug down, so they had a basement. And underneath there, they had the people from Disneyland build them caves with this jacuzzi that slid into all these different places and stuff like that. So, yes, that was there. And on top of it, Roger had a white Lamborghini Countach and a Testarossa side by side.
And so
he didn't win one Supercross race. He didn't even enter.
Yeah. Stay in school, kids.
That's right.
Do something different. So he would throw parties after the races.
He would throw everyone would go and would go to different places, then end up down there. Sometimes the parties got a lot better, I think, in the 90s.
They fine tuned them a little bit.
They stepped up the pace a little bit, but as Brock knows, we had some great end of year parties. I think we had a mini bike race. So, because like the big thing was all the guys would have 80s and XRs, 75s and stuff like that. So it was a lot of mini bike racing. After the last race, and I think San Diego was the last Supercross one year, and we had this race out in Jamul at Tripes' place or something like that just got completely out of control. So yeah, Daytona had some good ones too.
We did that one time. Do you remember? I don't want to jump the gun on this story because I really want to do it when Reed was here, but.
There was 03.
When Grant got the call in 03 that he won the championship, they canceled the last Supercross or the last National at Troy. And we were all staying at Brock Sellard's house in Ohio.
And there's no cell service, so they couldn't call any of us. So they had to call his home phone. And then they go, hey, there's a call for you. And
yeah, at Sellard's house, it's Chad Reed, myself, Ivan Tedesco,
there was a bunch
Grant.
There was a lot of people.
So he gets the call, and he hangs up the phone. I'm champion.
No, I kept saying, you guys are full of crap. I'm like, because I thought Brock had set it up, so I thought it was a prank.
Yeah.
I mean, who gets called? Oh, yeah. Think about it. Who gets called to get told that you won a championship?
And who was the person that told you?
Davey Coombs.
Oh, really?
He said, so, I'm sitting here with AMA.
I would think he was full
you're
of shit
on conference
too.
Call. And I'm like, you guys, I'm like, this is not even funny.
Yeah, I'm from South Africa. You don't do this.
Yeah, you don't mess with my emotions.
I'll bring out a tiger or lion.
Yeah, we bring
beat your ass.
We got a legal gun. Well, we'll sort you out.
we proceeded to build a pit bike track through his garage. Do you remember that?
We drove to Fred Andrews' store, bought all the 110s he had, because everyone said, you're rich. You just won. You got a big bonus.
You just got a bonus.
So I was, by this point, I was speaking Swahili. I'm like, I'll take all of them. And we bought all these 110s.
I speak perfect Swahili, so that means 10 XR75s.
Yeah. Anyway.
He's like, for real? You want me to write up the paper? Take them all. Got it. Load them up. Yeah, it got sideways. That'll be a good story, I think, one day.
We got to have Reedy on to talk about it, or Brock.
Yeah,
or both, even. Or Brock. All right, so jump into your first years with Yamaha. You actually, how did that first factory ride come about? You said you kind of got a support ride with the help of Glover.
Yeah, Brock got me a support ride, and then the year, my rookie year, because I had been doing really well in Southern Cal, but they gave the ride to Scott Burnworth, who he went from Suzuki over to Yamaha. And so they had him and Eric Kehoe, and then they had on the 125 support team, they had AJ Whiting, Troy Blake, and myself. And then I was doing good. I got The only time I had to do a qualifier was my first Hangtown National. And this was in 81, so they didn't have, actually, they did come out. That was the year they came out with the water cool bikes. so I was like top five, top 10. I was right in the mix. And then the field was fierce because you had Barnett, who was just, you know, had just been dicing with Brock for years over that 125 championship. So you had Wardy, you had O'Meara, and you had, you know, I think each team had like four or five guys, and so I was a support guy.
So stacked.
That era was unreal.
But I felt I had confidence because I raced with all these guys at Saddleback and Carlsbad in the off season, and that's the thing that everyone doesn't have. You have it now because everyone's here, but no one races, and they're on their own private little tracks.
Yeah. It's so different. You got and different for a reason. I guess guys have tracks that are watered and prepped and groomed. You didn't have that, so. In order to get testing, to get ready, you had to go race. And you guys were racing during the week and every weekend, Golden
State. We did the Golden State to get ready for Supercross. How stupid was that? We would go to Carlsbad the week before Anaheim. It was like, how's the bike? Hauls ass up the hill, you know? And then, so we're going to be making the adjustments. And then Brock and I got together at a place called Daly Ranch out in Hamul. And they basically didn't give us the property, but they said, you want to build something? Go for it. And so we... $30,000 or something like that, Brock, that we gave John Savitsky to build a track, and we had a really bitchin' track, and it was scary.
Back in that day, $30,000, I would have hoped it was a bitchin' track. That's a lot of money.
It was a lot of money, but it was a great track, and so I, you know, even though Brock and I started as Yamaha teammates, I was on Honda and that, but we needed a track down south, and we didn't want to buy the property and stuff, so we always used that and rebuilt it every year.
Savinsky was a badass, too. I remember one of the first times I ever got kind of up close to you factory guys, I was on a mini bike in Scottsdale, Arizona, where I went to high school and, you know, grade school. Do you remember that they had a supercross race that this guy put on? Savitsky built the track. It was called Horse World.
Yep.
Remember that?
Yep. I didn't race it, but I remember it.
There's a start gate was elevated, and he laid out this badass track that where it came and jumped back over the start gate. Do you remember that? I think Bale raced.
Yeah, a lot of people did. That was right when I got hurt. It was like right in 90, 91-ish, right in that time frame. And I remember the people that put it together. There's a great picture of the guy's girlfriend with Bob Hanna and a podium at Unadilla. If you Google that, you'll see something.
I think another picture.
You know that picture.
I didn't know the story behind the picture.
Exactly.
Not suitable for work.
Yeah.
But so John was very innovative, and he would tweak the tracks all night long, and that's what was great about him, because he started as a racer. John Savitsky and Bob Hanna were like really good friends, and he was from Pennsylvania, and his Bob was kind of quirky, didn't like many people and stuff like that, but he loved John. And so they would ride together, and kind of like what Brock did for me, streaming parts out the back door, he did that for Savitsky.
Let me ask you about tracks. This is kind of a little rabbit hole, but I'm going to dive off it anyway.
Yep.
In like late 80s, the tracks were pretty mellow, pretty flat, kind of rough, more motocrossy, right? And then they hit a point in the 90s somewhere where they got really gnarly. And if you go back and watch them... stuff is really peaky.
I agree.
Whoops were big. It got like really gnarly for a little bit, and it seems like now they've almost gone back and they're a little smoothed out again.
It's just the thing is in our generation, it was you had two strokes with power bands. You had to choose bottom end or top end, and then all of a sudden, then we got power valves, and all of a sudden we could kind of get some bottom end, still with some top end. We had traditional forks with real flexy, and so motocross, it kind of was good because everything moving around a little bit, but then when you try to be precise, going through the whoops, the wheel would tuck on you when you go over the bars. And then Keith Bowen was the first one to blitz the whoops just hanging off the back. It's like, oh shit, now we got to do that, you know? And then, but then the thing was, and then you had guys like Koji Masuda and Danny McGoo Chandler and stuff like that. They would just see these jumps. There'd be four jumps. Start off and go, oh, let's double it. Someone doubled it. Oh, shit, maybe someone will triple it. And then you had to do it.
There's always one asshole, right?
Well, exactly. And it never failed. That the takeoff jumps were like this, and then the other ones landing, in the middle were like that. So
especially back in the day, they didn't know. It was almost like they looked like they were backwards the way they set them up. It's like you do it perfect, you almost still killed yourself.
Right, or you landed completely flat and you broke wheels and stuff like that. So it was a different time, and they were learning and all the different stuff. So now it's the bikes are fuel injected. They're 450 cc's. They're so fast. The tire performance, how hard these guys can lean on the fronts. Like when we had them.
Especially those Dunlops.
Exactly. Those Dunlops.
But they also way better.
They squared them up and stuff like that, and the balance and all the different stuff that they're doing. It's just become so much more of a technical game. And the jumps, they go, this jump is this long. We're having two of these and two of those. I think it's complete bullshit that they're like, well, we can't have a right-handed first turn because the guy... Are you kidding me?
Hey, they were definitely more creative and different back then. They would make something completely random, almost... Let's see if we can screw these guys up and really get them off rhythm.
Exactly. And that's part of it. I think that's part of the great thing. And that's what you're seeing with the GP riders outdoors. The tracks are rougher and kind of crazier and more stuff's happening. It's not such a supercross, say, format.
More variants.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, they ride on, four different continents, different track designers, promoters, preppers. So you get more variants. And I think... Like what you're saying is what we're seeing moving forward these days is it's become more cookie cutter. It's just like we're going to put these obstacles in that layout.
Hey, I got a question. Didn't you ride a ProTec TT 600 and the four stroke naturals? And you said that a four stroke would be a better motocross bike than a two stroke way back then.
Yes. Well, partially true. That was 1982.
Look at that guy.
1983. Yeah, that was the last time I took David Bailey out really hard. And I did. We talked about it today.
And I did.
And we became friends after that because he took me out equally as bad at a Golden State race. And so, anyways, it is what it is. We're buddies now.
I was going to say, isn't that what most competitive-natured people do?
Yeah.
Take each other out at some point?
At some point, you don't know until you test the waters. But back to the four-stroke national is they had a Ben Allberg replica. And so when I was really young, I would race 125, 250, and 500 because on Wednesday night you could race all three classes and make, like $300.
That's crazy.
It's a lot of money.
A lot of change.
That's right. For a 14-year-old kid, I could race all three bikes. And that bike I'd leave in second gear because it had a piston about this big and about that flat. But I was really comfortable on it, and I could jump anything. I won the jump contest they had down there. And the four-strokes just had that roll-on power. And that's what back in these days, the Yamaha had that. Yamaha had that smooth bottom power because they were the first one to come out with that rolling power valve, not the guillotine.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like open, it would roll into it. And so that to me was the key, and that was the reason why I went with Pro Circuit, because the Honda had so much power on a dyno, it crushed everything. But I didn't have that feel to get through the corner. And the Pro Circuit pipe was a little bit softer on top, but I had so much more rideability, and I could ride it really hard from 0 to 40%, where the other one, I was kind of scared of it, and then I would use it in sand and Daytona and stuff like that.
Yep.
But having that rideable power, and that's why Mitch and I formed such a great relationship.
Yeah, you guys were close together. So I want to bring you back to something that might be a little painful.
Uh-oh.
82.
Saw Donnie Hansen today. I didn't punch him.
All right. Good for you. Yep. I can see the classes are paying off.
Yes.
Yeah. Money well spent.
And in fact,
USA,
this serenity now.
Yes.
You and GL have a lot in common here in this little world. In 82, you led that championship to the very end.
Yep.
And blew a front wheel out in Colorado.
Yes.
And lost it.
Most painful race of my life. It was my fault. I was dumb and stupid and young, and I thought... All I had to do was get 2 fifth places. I had a 20-some point lead on Donnie going into it. And what happened was...
Wait, you say two fifth places?
5-5. Five,
that's all I had to do was get a 5-5.
Okay.
I think so. If Donnie won both races.
Something
along those lines.
Gotcha.
And so I went out and Brock was in first, Donnie was in second, and I was like fourth behind Kenny Keelan, and I had the attitude, I'm going to win like a champion. I'm not going to sit back here. I'm going to show these guys. And I went flying past Kenny down the hill, landed. It broke one of those Z spokes, and then over the bars I went, and then I pushed it back, and we changed the wheel, and I worked my way up to 22nd. So I didn't get any points. So then the next race, Brock goes out, Brock takes off, and then Hansen's there. I pass Hansen. I keep running into him, because I have to.
You want to break his leg.
I'm trying. I was trying to break his leg, I was trying to break his arm, trying to break his bike, whatever, and he would just let off, and he would go by. And this is back when there were 45-minute motos. And I was just like screaming at him, calling him wuss and Bob, a bunch of other stuff, and he's just like, go ahead, go right ahead.
After you, sir.
Is that because he now had the points lead?
He had the point lead. He was going to win by 3 points if he followed me to the finish line. So I was like, I cried for 45 minutes, screaming and crying and just
scream crying.
Oh God, yeah. Ugly cry, everything. Crossed the line and I lost the championship.
Now,
threw it away.
Does this ring a bell for you?
Yeah, I won. My rear wheel went out. Yeah. I don't know what happened, but it blew out. It just started crumbling.
What was the scenario in Steel City? You had you and Mike Brown down to the wire.
I had to get ninth place if you won the moto, in the final moto.
Ninth?
Yeah, and I was second behind Carmichael.
You could stab yourself in the eye with a fork and get a ninth, probably.
And Brownie, he panicked on the opening lap, was in a pileup. I saw him go down, and I remember thinking, sweet, I'm good. I'm great. This is fun. Just, and then all of a sudden, I'm like, I'm like, what the hell? I thought I got a flat, but I can ride through this. I still got this. And then it wasn't a flat.
I call bullshit. I think...
Oh, okay.
I think him being a poor kid from South Africa says, if I win this moto, I'm going to get the overall bonus and the moto bonus and that. And you tried a little hard.
I can take some trophy girl home. This is going to be great.
Was there a little bit of truth to that? Could you have maybe gone a little slower?
Probably, yeah. For sure on that one. Yeah. No, I thought... Going into it, don't do anything stupid. And then that's why I remember thinking how frustrating it seemed when you thought you'd try to do everything correctly. And it just wasn't meant to be.
You suckers. Well, you guys are doing it all wrong. Just don't be in contention for a title.
That's right.
You never have to have that
thing. Then there's no disappointment.
Yeah, it doesn't hurt. but how bad was that, Grant? Is like when they say, be present, all the different stuff. You go, I want to be anywhere but present right now because this is my worst nightmare and it's happening to me.
I thought that was the one time when people say, that experience of thinking you're waking up from a nightmare. I remember at one point I had my head between my legs and I was crying and I looked up almost to see if maybe there was a reset button.
Right.
Like and I looked around and I'm like, I see the same assholes and they're all crying too. Screw this. Move on.
I actually had a similar situation when I led the 2001 25 championship and had a first turn pile up and bent my front brake carrier. And so my
I
front
remember
wheel,
watching this because this was the stuff I was watching when I came to the States.
So my front wheel was, the whole carrier was bent. So I couldn't just cut the line. Like everything was rubbing. So right. I every time I'd come off the ground, the front wheel would lock
Apple
up.
Ball.
And I don't know if you've ever ridden with your front wheel locking up. It doesn't work.
Yes.
You lean or have the wheel turned at all, you are crashing.
Yeah.
And so I was just panicking, like almost crying in my helmet, trying to go as fast as I could go. I could barely jump onto the finish line. And I think I got 16th or 17th.
And you needed
Shea Bentley
15th?
Won.
You needed like a...
14th? No, we ended up going to the last round. I had to win. He had to get 7th.
Hey, if anybody listened to just this 3 minutes, they'd think all three of you are losers.
What a bunch of sad sacks. I know.
Hey, at some point... Hey,
this is counseling right now, okay?
That's right. We're getting
this. I'm starting to feel better already.
This is cathartic. It's like therapy. That's thanks, guys.
I'm going to let that out.
This is right.
Moving on.
We deserve more championships. How about that? Wrap it
all
up.
All right. Screw 1982.
Yeah,
but yeah, right, I learned from that, and it shaped me to who I am. But it hurts. I'll be honest with you. There's times that I just go, "Damn, you're so stupid," you know. But honestly, I think that if I would have had the success, I think I probably would have done a lot more stupid things at the end of my Yamaha career. And like I said, that motivated me really a lot, and I had to grow up a lot.
Those things do shape you as a human being, even. Yeah. And I think, at least I tell myself this so I can sleep at night, help you to make better decisions just in life in general down the road and give you better perspective on what's important and what's not.
Well, not every lesson you learn, and we'll talk about this later, is something positive. I mean, a lot of things are really hard, even things that you learn from people or whatever. It's not some of the greatest lessons you learn aren't from a teacher or somebody that's trying to educate you. It might be from some drug addict that you saw on the street and you go, I do not want to be that guy.
Yeah.
I don't want to be that. So that he taught me not to be a loser. And so I'm gonna go away. And like I said, you don't always have the Brock Lovers in your life that do the right things and make the right choices and do the things that you go, wow, that adds to success. So sometimes you have to look at somebody that goes, well, that guy's kind of a dipshit, so I don't want to follow his tracks.
Yeah. He's a turd. Don't do what he did.
That's right.
True that.
All right, so 83, you had a hip, you were competitive but had a hip injury, right?
Broke a collarbone in Anaheim, came back, and then dislocated my hip in 83, and that was the most painful thing I ever went through. And the doctors kind of said, well, yeah, it's out for 5 hours, and you're probably not going to be able to race anymore. But for the grace of God, I haven't had any issues with it or anything like that. And once again, I I had my racing taken from me, you know, and I dropped out of high school. I'm not proud of that, but I'm not going to lie about it. I think a lot of people say, "Oh, I got my GED." I'm like, "Bullshit! You can't read fast enough to finish the GED in that much time." But there's a few guys that have graduated and have the time. My senior year came and went, and I wasn't there because I struggled with school and dyslexia and ADD, blah blah blah. But anyways,
you sound like most motocross racers. No, to be honest,
yeah.
This is one thing I've learned around the world. I thought it was just because I was from South Africa. I'm like, oh no, we're part of a breed.
Exactly. But the people that you can count on when crap goes bad.
Yeah.
So anyway, so I was laying in the hospital. They're saying you should be able to walk. We're probably gonna have to replace your hip and all the different stuff. But you're never racing again. And so I had this sobering moment that I've dropped out of high school. I'm terrible at everything but riding a motorcycle. What the hell am I going to do? And it broke me. And then all of a sudden, well, we did the test, and there's no artery damage or anything like that. And I was able to come back and meet a guy named John Alvarez in a training facility, and I got the strongest that I ever was, and came back and won the championship in '84. Was a great comeback.
Yeah. I say, what a story that is, too.
Yeah, well, and I've heard that, I've never dislocated a hip, but I've heard that's incredibly painful. I think McGrath did one year.
Yeah, that was at KTM.
Did
it.
Yeah. He said,
the bike bug.
I mean, he didn't have a lot of injuries throughout his career, but he said, man, that was unreal.
I think he had a hangnail one time.
I think
he did.
He cut his foot on a beer bottle.
He had ingrown toenails. That was the worst thing next to the dislocated hip.
Listen,
all shit aside, no, it is the most painful thing. I do not wish that on anybody because, like, my broken wrist, my shin, my collarbone, stuff like that. If you just don't touch it, it's like, it doesn't hurt. It's not that bad. But a dislocated hip is like having a broken bone and having somebody just sit there and just crank on it the whole time. You can't escape the pain.
So the only thing I can relate to is I've had kidney stones, and I don't know if you ever had
those.
I've
heard that's bad.
Holy shit. Like, when I, as a medic, when I go on calls and someone has a kidney stone, they're like, it's a kidney stone, I know it, and they're vomiting and rolling on the floor. I'm like, fentanyl, quit. And I'm like, IV's giving this guy, I'm just slamming as much as I can.
Well, are you doing it because you're like emotionally upset from when you had it before?
Yes.
You're like, he needs two, I need one. He needs two, I need one. Yeah. Two for him, one for me.
One, two, skip a few, three, four. I feel like I'm trying to one-up you guys, but I shattered my femur, which was the most painful
thing. I've done a femur. Femurs are for pussies.
And I had multiple surgeries to fix it where they took bone from my hip and this and that, and I was in and out of hospital for almost a year, and I was told I would never race.
Yeah.
And from being in hospital and everyone feeling bad for me, I was just chugging sodas and eating chocolate and whatever. I was a kid, and everyone feels bad for you. They bring all this cool stuff, which led to kidney stones.
Oh.
So at the age of 13, I went from a shattered femur and four surgeries and bone grafts and all this stuff to losing blood to having kidney stones.
Did you pass them or what happened?
Yeah. I mean, it was, I remember what you said. I just remember, I thought I was in the worst back pain.
This is a motocross show that we're doing.
Sorry. No, but we're going out. It's okay.
This is this is Racer MD.
That's right.
Yeah. Got any questions about kidney stones, call us. We'll answer them.
Okay, so my wife's here in the back. I'm just going to quantify my pain.
There we go.
She had a kidney stone. All right. She has given birth to two children.
Right.
She said she would rather have more children again.
But you're a little guy. They're little
kids. That's because she likes you. That's because she likes you.
My kids were this big.
They're like little tiny guys.
They slept in matchboxes. That's no big deal. Anyway, all right, moving on. So you got that first title. I want to go back. Soon after that, the World Supercross at L.A., they did this weird World Supercross round with the inverted start.
Yep.
Look at this. Hold on. Let me talk about this real quick.
GoPros.
First of all, badass mustache. I don't know why you don't have that still.
The mustache was rocking.
Yeah.
I wasn't mature enough to grow the gap. It's supposed to go all the way down, but there's big holes there. I didn't shave those off. Wasn't stylish.
I love how excited you look about that GoPro on your head.
Exactly.
There.
It's not a GoPro. This was a Go Amateur.
That's
a little different.
Yeah. I want to be pro.
pair of supercross. Hey, go do a couple laps. Oh, this should be fun.
You're like, one was good enough. Thank you.
One and done, bro.
But that World Supercross round, so for those who aren't familiar with it, they tried some new format where the better you did in your heat, you started in the back row, right?
They were going to put the winner, they were going to put top two in of all the heat races, I think it was, to the back. So I was in the first round. And so this was, I was testing on Hondas already. And so then Jim, so I couldn't race it on a Honda because Yamaha wouldn't let me out of the contract. So Jim Castillo says, I'll build you a bike. And so he built this carbon fiber tank that was all low down and stuff like that. Pro Circuit built the motor. Jake from Showa stole a set of forks from Honda and put it on the bike. And
sorry, Jake.
Yeah, there I am.
Well, we got the interview.
Yeah, we don't need to listen to it. It's pretty bad. Anyway, so I'll talk so, over.
And Jim Castillo, for those who don't know, just let me fill this in. He is the owner, inventor of
I really thought they were more professional than that. I didn't think that, you know, when I said I was going to come out here race to win, I'm here to race to win. If you're capable of winning the qualifier, then you should be on the back row. They want to test this rule to see if it's fair. And now, here, you know, here I am the only one, and I'm riding a privateer bike tonight. So who's a man and who's chicken is the way I look at it.
Did it ever cross your mind to sandbag?
It crossed my mind, but I really thought it wasn't fair to the people, you know, and it isn't fair to the system. They want to try the system out, see how the second row start works in case if they want to use it for a next year format. And now all these guys are just sandbagging. If I was the crowd, I'd get up and walk home.
Okay, now.
All right, hold on. That's enough of the interview. True words, though. How about those true words?
All right, so this is, now you're looking at a person that feels like a complete jackass, all right, because I was in the first heat. I thought, I'm going to go do this. It'd be fun. I like to start from the back. There's no point, blah, blah. It'd be fun. I like to pass guys. And all of a sudden, I'm like, oh, shit. They're all sandbagging. Oh, I'm the idiot. Yeah.
No, it was it was embarrassing, though. The guy, I can't remember who was up front and doing it, but they like the looked it down John, at their bike.
No, John Vandenberg. Vandenberg is like comes out, and he's like going, oh, no.
It's WWE.
And all of a sudden, he gets into third place. He goes, brrr. And just starts trying back.
And the bike stopped smoking and cutting out.
At least Wardy went up and stopped at the top. And he just like didn't. I'm like, where the hell is he? And then Wardy, I mean, and then all of a sudden, I think Dogger's in the same heat. He like sees him. He stops. Now they're all looking at each other. No, you go, you go. And then some jackass that never qualified. Yeah. Like, they're stopping. I'm making it. So those are
Phil
the
Larson. Those are the Phil Larson. I think he jumped into like second or something.
Yeah, and those are the assholes that start on the back row with me. And I got a terrible start. One of the guys crashed.
Shocker.
And his bike hit me and broke the gas tank.
Shoulder,
and I was done.
Trying to find look, out where the runners up may be.
Look, oh, my bike. Something's wrong. Holding his kill button.
Is that Dogger?
That's Dogger. He's holding the kill button. Now here's Vandenberg.
Vandenberg looks at him.
Vandenberg says, I'm going to stop too.
This is incredible.
Here comes the Phil Larson.
Look how slow they're going.
Vandenberg, watch him right here. He comes up lame right about here.
No way.
Vandenberg stops, dude.
Oh, something's wrong.
Oh, I know what's going to happen now. They're all.
No, you could clearly see he hit his chest on the bars. It was pretty clear.
Phil Larson's going to win it.
There it is. And Ron Lachine puts himself exactly where he wants to be. Third place. Vandenberg.
That was a.
That's why I was so pissed off. So
that was a sad night for Supercross racing.
And I was sucking helium before that interview because my voice was really high.
I didn't want to say anything, but I
don't. And now, who's a man and who's a chicken? That's right. When you're ready for battle, everything sucks up really tight. So I was ready for battle, but yeah, didn't work out for me that night.
All right. So that bike, you kind of described that. A guy, Simon916 on Instagram, wanted to know what was about that bike. So Castillo built it for you. ProCircuit built the engine. It was kind of cobbled together.
It was an 85YZ. It had a ProCircuit motor, had Showa forks on it, had an Olean shock on it. Jim Castillo, Innovation Sports now, asterisk, yep. Built a carbon fiber tank all low to make it look kind of like a Honda and stuff like that. It rode good and was fun to ride. You know, I went from testing on Thursday on my Honda to riding that. And then, as you can see, my wardrobe was really fancy.
Yeah, what's the story there?
Well, that was...
this Life's a Beach day?
Life's a Beach stuff. And so I met those guys. Brock and I actually met them together down in Gainesville in 1984, and they were selling them out of the back of a U-Haul. And so they gave us some shorts and this and that. So I started hanging out. So I said to Kenny Clark, who was the manager at Yamaha, I said, can I put these shorts over the top of my stuff? Because everything back then was like Speedos and little short shorts. And he goes, win the first moto, you could ride nude. I don't give a shit. So I'm like, I won the first moto, so I put them on. So then after that, they sold all of them because I got the whole shot that my shock broke and I ended up back ways. But anyways, they sold all the shorts out. We became friends and they started they were motorcycle guys, started a surf company and they did well.
And that bred Bad Boy Club?
Yeah, so Bad Boy Club came out of that. And then that was when we had a partnership with JT, which was towards the end of my career. I was on my way down, so I had a bad...
Yeah, the logo. I know people that got that tattoo. So a lot cool. of people got that tattoo.
I remember the stickers.
In their 50s right now with that tattoo.
They're a little bit saggy, you're looking.
Yeah. You know, yeah.
Like,
He's got a long arm.
His face is melting.
Is that an arm?
So, let's shift gears.
Yes.
You had your time, Yamaha custom bikes. Then all of a sudden, Honda.
Yep.
Production rules came into effect. What was that like?
Well, so I had a little bit of a precursor to that. After 82, I went and tested, and I wanted to stay loyal to Yamaha, and I didn't go to Honda. So Roger and Dave Arnold, we always were in, you know, not in contact, but they were always nice to me and that. And then so I was going to sign with Yamaha, and they called me. It was like on a Wednesday morning. I was going to go up and sign my contract. And Roger said, hey, would you be willing to try the bikes? I said, yeah. So I met him down at Carlsbad at a place called, not the Flower Track, but another one off by La Costa. And they brought down Dogger's Works 85. And I rode this thing.
250?
Oh, God. This thing was so unbelievable. So the Tono, the guy who was the shock guy, watched my style. He said, I can build a suspension for him. I had literally got on the bike, went like that with the bars. I raised them up like 10 millimeters, and I went out, and I was not joking. And I went hard on my practice bikes. I could go 4 seconds a lap faster, but the forks worked, you know, because that, and Brock can tell you, when Yamaha was doing production bikes while there was still a works rule, they were complete production. We had Simons, anti-cab kits. We had an Olean shock. That was it. And then Bud Asklund built a pipe for us, and they were production bikes, way more production than they are right now. And so when I got on the thing, I just fell in love with it. But what I loved was the adjustability. I knew that we were going to go to production bikes. We weren't going to get those bitchin' bikes, but I just loved the effort that Honda was putting forward. And when you had Roger DeCoster.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He's sitting there looking at you going, well, I think I would do. I'm like, you do whatever you want. Yeah. You know, you want me to ride backwards? I'll ride backwards.
So was Roger already the man back then?
Well, he was more the man because he had just retired from being
the man. Yeah,
he was racing in the man. So, but it was a great. I think that was the dynamic duo that of racing that was really, really hard to beat. Mark Blackwell was an unbelievable team manager because he was a racer / manager. But when you had Dave Arnold handling this, I'm going to call it the day to day stuff, the technical stuff, and you had Roger. I mean, because when Roger DeCoster would come up to you and tell you there's a line on the right, you know, you went on the,
you
on
went
the right
to the
left, whatever he said, you did. And having that kind of confidence, and then you also had where they worked well off of each other. And so, and then they also had the Showa engineers and the Honda engineers and stuff like that. And when I showed up, and when Brock and I were at Yamaha, we'd go up and we'd have like two pipes and one cylinder and a shock and a spring or something like that. And they show up and there's like, wait a minute. I got five pipes to try and two cylinders, and there's another test bike and all the different stuff. Multiple. It was just crazy.
And what Roger had mentioned too was back then they had a really direct line to Honda, the factory Honda. So if you wanted something or they wanted something, they made a call and it was done.
Yeah.
And that went away over time.
I was going to say, and I really felt like that's, I think, what helped Honda was having the right, you know, people delivering messages and them taking the messages and working on it. I mean, that really helped.
So how much better was that works bike? I mean,
here's the thing.
How long until a production bike could compete with that 85 works bike?
And that's the thing. You could get more out of it. You could get more out of, like, Brock. Brock won championships on that air-cooled 460 or 490 or whatever it was, and that thing was a pile of shit. I mean, that thing was terrible. But when you ride something every day and you're crossing it, you got the same tires as the next guy, you learn how to adapt. But the comfort that those bikes had was just unbelievable. The forgiveness on the body and hitting bumps, and you weren't like just hanging on waiting for the front wheel to blow out from underneath you and stuff. That was the key there, and it was just the ability for them to give you the effort. You're going to put this effort out, we're going to reciprocate, and that's what made I think that's what made riders so strong, because Mr. Honda was alive, and you had Dave, who was a mechanic, and you had Roger, who was the world champion of all world champions at the time, and it just made for an environment for success. You could almost not succeed.
I was going to say that, but that's almost like most successful businesses. You need the genius in the back making the product and someone in the front steering how that business is ran, theoretically a race team. So it makes a lot of sense.
But
the great rider with it, you know.
But Honda did that all the way through. They had Gene Romero, who was on any Sunday.
I remember.
He took their flat track team to the top. They had Bruce Ogilvie, who was a desert racer, raced for Yamaha. They took their off-road team to the top. So Honda was very good at picking the right person, You know what I mean? If you get the wrong person to do something, you know, not every rider can do that.
Yeah. So where do you think, this is kind of going off on a little bit, but where's Honda gone wrong? Because at a time they were so dominant, and that hasn't really been the case for
quite a while.
15 years?
Yeah. Pretty much since Ricky, I think. The other Ricky.
Right. No.
Not that they don't say the other Ricky, but...
Yeah, not that they don't the make other Ricky, but...
RC.
Yeah.
Not RJ.
I think they just got comfortable. I think they got comfortable, and I think that they really lost... When they lost Mr. Honda, they lost a lot of direction. Because when I was able to meet him once, of course, I was one of the... I did very well in Japan Supercross. This is one of the ones I lost. Well, he was there for that. Something. Oh, God, that was terrible. That was a very uncomfortable meeting in the pit afterward. But Mr. Honda was very driven to be the best, because if you look at what Honda did, it wasn't just motocross. It wasn't just motorcycles. It was F1. It was IndyCar. I mean, they didn't just do good. They dominated. I mean, think about that. GPs.
Yeah.
Freddie Spencer.
Two-wheel, four-wheel,
everything. Yeah. And Mr. Honda and his son, Hiro Mugen, Honda was, they pushed that. And they there was like, there is no second place.
So you think they've just sort of lost some of that competitive drive, whether it was his passing or...
I think it's too corporate.
People said he had the racing passion, and then Honda became,
right,
what you just said, just a business.
Bunch of pencil pushers.
Yeah.
Yeah,
to a degree. Yeah. What about Lunas? I bumped into him today at Anaheim. Yeah. He was a big part of your program back then.
Very big.
Brian Lunas.
Yeah. So Looney, we hated each other at the beginning because he worked for Donnie Hansen. And so
great start.
Yeah, great start. So the first race that I won was in '82 at Hangtown, and they said it was so muddy that they allowed you. This was the first race where they wouldn't let you go on the other side of the gate. But they said it's so muddy, you can go on the other side. So I'm over there prepping my spot, and Lunas is going, get out of there, he's cheating this, that. And so I'm like, F you. And so we're going back and forth. And I'm like, you know, the AMA official. And so then that kind of started our little battle. Then Donnie and I, and you know, that's, I was a little more aggressive back in '82. And so I would hit Donnie, and Donnie would be really smooth. And I hit Donnie, and Lunas would come up before race, because you know, if you did that to Hannah, you take your ass out. I'm like, well, I'm not racing Hannah, am I? You know what I mean? So,
exactly.
So we didn't like each other a lot. And then so when I went and tested and went up there in 1982 afterward, after Donnie got hurt, I'm walking through the mechanics area, and he's over there, he's looking at me, he's mad dogging me, and I just walk by and I just go, you know, and I keep walking, and I never thought he'd be my mechanic. And
so how was that? Hey, good to meet you.
No, so then I saw him later on. He goes, you know, I saw you. I'm like, I had it up here.
I hope you saw it.
Exactly. So then, come 1986, it was between him and Eric Krippa. And so I met with both of them. And Krippa was an El Cajon guy, also from Don Vesco's and back in the day and stuff. But so Looney and I talked, and we kind of said, and I saw just the dedication in him, and that he would, you know. And actually, Bob Hanna called me, and Bob didn't like me. Bob called me and said, hey, I'm going to be moving on. I'm telling you, Brian's the guy. He'll put the hours in and all the different stuff. He's not a charmer. He's not he's not a sweet guy, but he put me first. Yeah. And he created a wall between me and everybody.
Yeah.
Like, he would just like sit there, and I was like the dog, and he would just piss me off all day long and just go. You know, I would get third in a qualifier, and he would just yell at me like my dad, you know. And
we need that as racers, though, right? I mean, I always liked when I had a guy who would defend me. Like, you know what you're saying, he would yell at you to protect Donnie. You want that guy that's got your back, and you know he's got your back all the time. I mean, to me, that was a good mechanic.
No, he was a great mechanic, and like, here was the epitome of it. And so in 1986, I got beat by David, and then I was leading Houston, and I crashed. And so Houston, the next weekend was San Diego. And so I wasn't the... race bike was so much faster. I would just, my timing was off. You know what I mean? And so I would over jump stuff, or I'd under jump stuff and stuff like that. And so I came in, and he's like, dude, what do you get tired? I'm like, no, man, I can't time these jumps because I'm not used to the bike. He's like, what do you need to ride more? I said, yeah, be at my track on Tuesday. So he drove all the way there. I tested on my bike Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, or actually Tuesday, Wednesday, got two full days of riding it. He prepped it. We did press thing, and I won San Diego. So it was that kind of commitment that he's willing to drive. And that was back when he was box van, and he just like packed up. And Houston's not exactly a short trip. No. That's a good full 2-day trip.
You have a birthday just getting out of Texas.
Exactly. Yeah. And so that's what we had, and it was a good combination.
Yeah. That's when mechanics were men.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a different world. Like, not to diss guys now, but
well, they did back then. Everything. They were your man friend. They helped you. They cleaned your gear. They did all that stuff. Now you got a whole array of things. But I heard you talking about 86 and got to ask about Majura.
Yeah.
That, you know, everyone talks about it being, you know, the dream year.
Well, the planets all aligned, okay? You had, for one, you had three guys that were really strong, all on the different stuff. And Johnny went back down to a 125, and he was small, and he was unbelievably fast.
Was there any tension about that, or was he like, no, I'll go down, no problem?
There was no tension about that, but don't spoil the story.
Oh, Pingy. Sorry. Okay, sorry.
God dang. It's only a second show, folks. He'll get there. Anyhow, so we did that, and so I get there, and we've been racing Supercross. Brock was part of the team with us in 84. When all of a sudden now we're jumping these big tabletops and stuff. We're not just doing it like we're using Supercross techniques and motocross, which is part of the game now. But the European guys don't do that, you know. So we had that advantage. And this track, honestly, was very similar to Carlsbad and some of the tracks that we raced, the hard dirt, and stuff like that. So then what we get there, and so big to my surprise, we get there, and all of a sudden Johnny and David were like they were over to the side and stuff like that. We find out that Johnny's fired, that he's gone. So it's like, oh, don't I feel like the asshole, you know? So now I'm still – so because there was always – Johnny and David had their thing, which I admired it and respected it and tried to train with them, and they about killed me on bicycles and stuff. So I had my own camp over here. So when we were there, we worked together. But that race, man, Johnny was flying. Like the first race was 125-250. I'm in front, and Johnny's just like, just up my ass the whole time. I'm like, I'm not going to let you by. Just stop.
It's not supposed to work this way.
Just relax. We're so far out in front and stuff. I'm just like, would you just relax? I wanted to save some energy. And then the second moto, he gets second again. And so we joked about this. So what would it be bitching if we went 1-2 and all the motos? And so then the last moto, David got out in front, and I was dicing with Thorpe. By the time I got by him, Dave was gone. David let off. We went, you know, the last lap side by side and different stuff. Coming into the last corner, I tried to, I was going to, I forget how it went, but anyways, I hit David's back wheel and I fall down. So the finish line's right there, and I look at him like, what are you, asshole? You know, so I pick up my bike, we go across the finish line, and I grab his hand and I raise his hand because he won.
Yeah.
But somebody actually said to him, did you see that? He tried to take your hand off. You make sure that you tell them that you won. I'm like, I wouldn't do that, you know. And
I remember that's an iconic picture. I remember that.
I was going to say, the picture doesn't look like you grabbed his hand off the bar.
Yeah. So no one, you guys were far enough in front. No one caught you.
No one was even near us.
And so you learned that Johnny wasn't being hired back again at Honda that weekend. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, before the race. So we knew that was his last race. And that was very hard for Johnny and David because they were best friends, man. Yeah. They both had houses up in Simi Valley. They trained together. Their ladies were friends, and I came in and I messed that up. And like I said, I had Brian who's like, screw those guys. You know, you just be the man and stuff like that. So he took the attitude that he took with Hannah and brought that in with me, and it worked.
I remember you saying those two were just super tight, and you tried kind of getting into the little clique, and they weren't necessarily rude to you, but you couldn't really...
I tried to go bicycle riding with them early in the year, and they about killed me.
You show up with spandex on. Hey guys!
Oh no, I had like a sweatshirt. I looked like Rocky. I had like Chuck Taylors on. I'm like, oh, let's go ride. They destroyed me because those guys did triathlon camps and all different stuff. And then that's when I said, I'm just going to go do my thing down at my track, and build my bike the way I'm going to do what I want to do. I don't care what they do. And like I said, I had Mitch Payton come down with a gas welder and like five pipes and cut them and try this and try that and try this. And I'm like, this is the one. And that became the pipe.
And your stomping grounds, if I remember right, was Palm Avenue. I made it down there a couple times before it all got leveled and developed.
We went there when the old KTM race shop was based in Alcohol.
Right,
so we got to go down there a couple of times. I remember that. I was like, oh, this is where all the guys rode. Yeah, sick.
That's
like, it's actually not that sick.
Yeah.
It's just on the side of the hill.
Yeah.
The track was rough as hell, hard as a rock. It was like Carlsbad.
Yeah.
If it never got prepped.
Yeah. And on a 500, you were going like 90 miles an hour.
Yeah, I was about to say, with everything, the tires barely on the ground even.
There was fun cliff jumps, though. I mean, that was a big playground.
Yeah.
Especially after a rain or something.
Well, and that's where you had guys like Craig that would just go, oh, hey, watch this. You're like, holy shit, where did that go?
Yeah.
You know, and so in Bader Monet, and I mean, so there's a whole bunch of these guys that would go down there. We would do motos sometime, and then we'd go, oh, let's play Follow the Leader. and you just go. You just take off, and you're just going through the hills and do all the different stuff, and then you'd have some straggler guys that would be stuck in the hills. And so, but it was just fun riding. And now it's just I have to do my so many motos, my warm-up, my this, my that. But
and then get back to my racing, social man. Media.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was definitely Carmichael's that changed that again. Before we move forward, though, Anaheim 1's tomorrow.
Yep.
I know this has been talked about to death, but Anaheim 86, the opener.
Yep.
You were in Bailey's battle. I've always wanted to know kind of just what was going through your head during that race.
Well, to back up, I was I overtrained. I trying to cram too much training in, and I got sick. I had like pneumonia a couple weeks before, and I couldn't do the first round up in Castaic or something like that, Gorman. And then I did the next race, and I felt pretty good. So during the race, I won my heat race. Wardy had that situation where the chain fell off, and so he didn't make the main event. And David won his race. I got a good start. Scott Burnworth and I came together. I had hit him in a Golden State passing him because the guy got hole shots all the time and stuff. So we're coming down to Sand Hill, and he was there, and I was there, and boom, I sent him flying. So that was like a couple weeks before. And so then everyone sees the first, you know, go around the first turn, we go off, and he's coming into me, and I'm just like, here we go. And so I throw a shoulder into him, and I wasn't trying to take him out. I just didn't want us to tangle. So when I hit him, I outweighed him probably by 25 pounds. He takes a right there, boom. So he's not really happy at this moment. You know, he's like,
oh, he's not laying under his bike. He's not happy?
No, he's not happy. And so he's not real stoked right now. So then I catch him, and he blocks me, and he admitted that later. But I probably would have because he's thinking, damn it, he took me out again. And so I get a good lead, but then all of a sudden I start running out of gas because I didn't have the lungs for it. And David caught me, and then I'd wore myself out. And so then when he got by me, I tried to hang on, and I just, you know.
But you, I mean, obviously this race will go down in history. It's one of the best battles ever. I mean, as you guys were going back and forth and back and forth.
That was the first Supercross I ever saw on a VHS.
Nice. Was it on beta?
It was like in 90. I don't even know what it was. I don't know. Was it a friend of a friend's place or my dad's who I didn't know? But I was just like, wait, what is this?
Yeah, you better hope someone didn't motocross. Didn't like video over it with some spicy channel or something. You're like, oh my God, what is that?
Like he's hammering the whoops.
So yeah, so at this point I had to, and also I ran the upside down forks because I could blitz the whoops a lot harder. But if you watch, the front wheel bounces up. It didn't. The upside down forks didn't work as well. If you notice, I'm a lot more nose high, and so
still
when I was
hauling the mail, man.
But what would happen is I was always just a little bit off, and so like landing off of the jumps and stuff like that, you really noticed it where David pulls up on me because the traditional forks landed and they just absorbed so much more, but I could hit square edge stuff so much more. So I was really pushing for the upside down fork because I was a little bit bigger and stronger. But I went back to them to the traditional fork for a couple races. Then I came back after we got these figured out.
Would you say maybe that was? I mean, you know, from some of them watching, your style and technique was different. David was very meticulous. He was a perfectionist.
Absolutely.
Probably a bit more like, you know, your modern day might be someone like a Marvin Musquin.
Yeah.
Where you were, I think, cleaner than someone like Carmichael, but you
look
did. You had
look.
More of the bulldog. I mean, you watch your well, not that style, but I'm talking about your riding style.
I missed that hair.
It was
wasn't
great.
Wasn't that awesome hair?
Oh, man. If you didn't have hair showing off the back of your helmet,
no,
you
it was,
sucked.
You had
yeah,
to have the
it.
Flow.
It was reserved for
but
champions.
But, no, that was the thing, though, is that's where I would make time. I would jump further coming in into the stuff and hit things harder. But with this, with those forks, they just didn't have the action. They had a little bit of a return to them. And if you watch me on some of these jumps, I kind of bounce on the second one. I'm not making any excuses. David whipped my ass, and he was better than me that night. And he was stronger than me, and I went home and did my homework.
Yeah. Champions don't have to make excuses. We've all had nights where you're like, I wish I would have done that or not done that. But
absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, I want to ask you that about champions specifically. I mean, I've heard you say you always knew you could win. Like, you always believed that you could win.
Yeah.
And I listened to a guy like Chad Reed, who hasn't won in years. And I bet if you talk to him tonight, he believes he can win.
Well, that was the thing. Weekend, I'm listening to this. I don't know what I listened to at this press conference today, but damn, we got to find a personality besides Chad Reed. I mean, there's like a talk about that you say, you know, about as exciting as a popcorn fart. These guys all got questions, and all of them avoided it and just said, made noise and didn't answer it. But I just wanted to say is, are you up here because you think you're going to get fifth or you're going to pace yourself? It's bullshit. Honestly, people, let me just tell you how this is. If you've ever been in a fist fight, when you start, you're not pacing yourself. This isn't the UFC. You don't have five rounds. You're going to go, I either need to kill this guy or he's going to kill me, and I'm going to give it all I got until it's over. And that's what a supercross is. You, when the gate falls, you take off as fast as you can go. You don't get a call from Harry High to say, okay, Cole, let's go now. You're on as going as fast as you can, and hopefully your lungs, because even though how great a shape you are, if you start holding your breath,
was that
screwed.
A Days of Thunder reference?
That's Days of Thunder.
Holy
that's right.
Shit.
Well, no, it's the same thing.
Holy shit.
I can't. From the outside, you got some fresh stickers on there, RJ.
They will hold if you go wide.
But, no brakes necessary.
But the thing is just that they're all like, well, you know, I'm going to try to do good. Like, what are you going to hurt the guy's feelings? No, he's going to take you out if he needs to, and he's going to do whatever he needs to do. And,
I didn't mean to take you out.
It was totally accidental. That was Mike
when I
Bell.
The brakes.
Mike Bell would do that. He'd take your legs off, and he'd go, oh, hey, Rick, are you okay? I didn't mean to do that. I'm like, get out of here.
Come on, RJ.
You're not guilty
of doing the same thing? You've gone and apologized to someone saying, dude, my brake pads were
gone. No, I didn't do that.
And
I was more truthful. I just said, I didn't mean to hit you that hard.
Yeah. I didn't mean to hit you that hard.
I threw the rock at him, teacher. I didn't mean to hit him in the face.
Yeah. Well, we'll get to personality. Right. That's another question I want to get at. But I'm talking about the mental aspect of this. How does a guy like Reed, who hasn't won in years, still believe that he can win? And I mean, how do these guys get that way? What's the difference between that, a guy like you, a guy like Grant even? But I'm always interested in this question. How do you get that kind of belief in yourself?
A lot of it is, you know, like we'll talk about this later, is you get the sweetness from your mom and the fighter and your dad. And if you've met Grant's dad, he's a gritty son of a bitch, and he pushes that. Same with Bill Bell, you know. Your dad is the one. Same with Dick Glover Brock's dad and Dick Lachine and all the, you know, all the different ones. They're going to push you to be a man even though you're a boy. And so then all of a sudden you get to that level. You just go, I wouldn't race unless I thought I could win. You know, and I honestly believe Grant feels, I mean, yeah, not Grant, you're Grant. Chad thinks he can win, and that's a championship mentality because he's riding the bike, he's flowing, he's doing this, he's doing that. And he's, I don't think he's here to break LaRocco's records or do that. He honestly, it hurts him when he doesn't win.
Yeah.
You watch him after the race when he's like fifth or sixth or whatever, he's not like, yeah, I just, you know, I'm two races closer to LaRocco's all-time run, whatever. So, that's what you got to have it, and that's what that's how you got to find these champions.
Well, I've seen Reed happy with the fourth and extremely pissed with the fourth, you know. So it's not so much a result, I think it's what you think you can do. And his situation, ironically, was a little bit different. His dad wasn't, you know, down his throat the whole time. He separated from his dad at a younger age, and I always said to him, what motivated you? And he was leaving the country saying, I'm going to go and kick everyone's ass. I didn't want to fail. And I think there's a little bit of that. I know you well enough to know that there's an ego inside of you that says, if I'm going to go out there and do this, I'm going to do it, and I'm going to kick everyone's ass while doing it.
Agree 100%.
And that's what I've always respected as well.
Well, from Chad, is that and one thing that he did say about his dad, he says, everyone bleeds. You hit them hard enough, they'll go down. And then that's why we're over at the Paris Supercross, where him and Jeremy got into it and all the different stuff. Chad came over here a complete underdog and set the world on fire. And that's the thing. He wasn't over here doing that. That takes a lot more respect than, oh, well, you were raised from the system, from a 50 Southern California kid in doing what you got to do, or a Florida kid, or blah, blah, blah. So I got a lot of respect for Chad. And as you said, he also separated from his parents at a younger age, and he was forced to become a man.
Yeah. Absolutely. For me, I just am always amazed by that a guy that can do that, just believe that he can win and then back it up and do it, you know. That's always been incredible to me, and I like to hear those stories from you guys. Any other good motocross donation stories?
Yeah, I was going to say, we do know one, and should we just get to it? I'm asking about this recent one as well.
There's a dogger story.
Right.
And I think this would be a great one to hear.
All right.
Yes.
I cleared this.
We always
got to
have a dogger story.
Did somebody else have something in there?
That's going to become a standard question. What's your best Ronnie Lachine story?
Yeah. Well, someone put in the questions about me punching Ronnie in the face.
That came from Eric Johnson. We'll get to that.
We'll get to that, too. So Ronnie and I, since then, have buried the hatchet. We're great friends, and I have been called to get clearance on this. So we are set up for the 1988 Motocross Nations. Wardy's on 125, I'm on 250, and Dogger's on 500. Dogger goes to Holland and does a supercross. Yes. All right, you can see him back there. And so,
is this the year?
This is the year. That's it right there. So Wardy and I were always good at burying the hatchet. You know, we went after each other tooth and nail during the year. But whenever the nations came together, we always worked really hard. And we were on the team with Hannah the year before. And so we were always good at those races. So Wardy and I go out for a run in the morning, and this is like on like a Wednesday before the thing. And so we had a friend of Ronnie's named Kenny Dunlop who was there with him. And so I go, like, I'm jogging. I get back to my room, and it's like 9 o'clock in the morning, and these windows open up in the hotel, and there's like a table like this. And I go by, and then I see Dogger passed out on the couch at 9 o'clock in the morning. And Kenny's over there where there's pizzas and liters of Cokes and stuff like that. And he's rolling a joint, and there's a big pile of weed. I'm just going, oh, shit, we're done. We are so screwed. I'm not saying that Ronnie Sheen smoked it, but he could have ingested some secondhand smoke, okay?
Possibly.
Possible. So I pull Roger aside. I go, Roger, we have a situation, because FIM, they drug tested you and stuff like that. So, like I said, we didn't say Ronnie smoked, but that he could have possibly tested positive. So we made sure there's little bottles of urine of Wardy's and mine all over the place so that if they came to our pit after the race, you just stick it in there and keep it warm in your body so the temperature reads and stuff like that. And I knew I was clean, and Wardy knew he was clean, and so they never checked us. Ronnie went 1-1, I went 1-2, and Wardy won that. We won the championship. But, yes, it was never a dull moment with the Dogger, but he was on fire that day. He was flying.
And also burning it down. Lots of fire.
Yes.
The Dogger.
Pingree wouldn't approve. Fireman Ping.
Yes.
Put that out, folks. Fire has it.
In your opinion, what year were you at your very best? What was the peak for you?
88. 88, it was, I think that I had my mentally I was smarter than I was in 87. 86, I was just sheer aggression. And I think that in 87, a lot of people caught on to the pace that I was running. I was high in fashion. That's the way I walked around. Remember I talked about those Chuck Taylors? There they are.
There they are.
There they are.
Stupid
things you do. When
hey,
you're,
guys, ready to go bicycle riding?
That's right. And I don't know why I couldn't keep up with them.
But you could keep it up. The plate's still there.
Just stick it through that little noddle. The bike was good. It was very comfortable. It wasn't, the Honda was way better in soft conditions. The Kawasaki and the Yamaha had more weight to the front, and they cornered better. But when you got to Daytona, and Brock knows this, is that I could do things on that Honda that Brock couldn't even think about doing on a Yamaha, you know. But if you had the hard pack stuff, and the majority of what we did, you know, out in Southern California and stuff like that, the Yamaha's cornered really well. And I just, I had the right balance. I could ride wide open the whole time because I was, you know, Brock started helping me out a little bit after I got hurt, but we had a lot of triathletes back in our neighborhood, Mark Allen and Scott Tinley and Scott Molina and all these great guys. And I would watch them and I would go, how the hell can they run at like max heart rate all day and I'm having trouble doing 30 minutes? So yeah. I just started pushing myself and then starting to use a heart rate monitor and changing my diet a little bit and this and that. And I could go wide open. So it didn't matter. So I knew when I sat on the starting line, and you guys can verify this. I think the biggest fear of a racer is when you sit on the line is I'm going to get tired.
I can't go my fastest this whole time.
I can't. But I knew that. So I knew that I would sit there relaxed because I'm like, if I just get a top five start, I'm going to just go as fast. I'm going to go wide open the whole race and they'll give up.
Yeah. And I think that's a big, that is the crux of Alden Baker's program.
Yes.
He gets you to that point.
Yep. Mm.
Of all of the things that he does, I think that's the most important. So that Moose can, whoever's down there with him, they're on the line saying just what you just said.
Well,
I'm not getting tired.
But understand this, people, is that the pain never goes away. Just because you can do that long of a moto that fast, it still hurts.
Yeah.
I mean, you're still, when your heart rate's peaking at, you know, like in Supercross, sometimes I was getting over 200 and, and I was like, you know, your windpipe's drying out,
taste
starting to taste the blood and stuff like that. And then everything gets kind of wacky. But you just go, it's not going to kill me. I can go. And then, so I had this transition in my racing career because when I raced like against Mark Barnett and Brock and the guys that were so strong and they would go so fast, I would just be like, I'm getting tired. How are they not getting tired? I'm getting so tired. How are they not getting tired? Too, I would spin it to go, I'm getting tired. They're going to give up.
They're getting more tired.
I'm hurting a lot. They're going to give up any second. And so you have to, and that's one of the things that Ricky Carmichael, I think, did better than anybody in the sport is he was willing to run straight into the wall and try to knock it down. You know, that I saw a race between him and Villeman. I think it was at Indy or something like that. And Villeman had him beat. And Ricky caught, and then Villeman just gave
grenade.
Up. And I talked to Ricky after that, and he goes, I was willing to hit the wall. I didn't care, but I wasn't going to give up. And I said, damn, that's a hard. So a guy that's willing to die that you fight against, that you better think
that's
about
it.
That's a
tough guy to beat.
How many times in the last 20 years or so have you thought about just punching Danny Storbeck in the neck?
Never.
Or the throat.
You liar. You lying bastard.
No, so let's tell that story. So
I
want to
hear
about the wrist story.
How did the crash happen? I have actually never heard details.
So to start off, Danny Storbeck and I were good friends. You know, he would come out to Southern California and hang out with me, and his dad was hung out with my dad and everything. So we were good friends. At the end of 85, he roosted me. Actually, the start of Washougal hit me in the finger, and it broke my finger. So that I was off my bike for a little bit before I got signed with Honda. So what happened was Danny was kind of like Scott Burnworth, always got good starts, but really fast. But for shorter periods of time, he would always fade and this and that. So we're in practice. Stanton's behind me. We're catching Danny, and I'm kind of going and getting my speed. I'm like, God damn, get out of the way, Danny. I'm kind of moving. And he's going, doing his thing. And so they ran the track backwards that year, I think. Yeah. So
Gainesville.
Yeah, Gainesville. So we came around, and then there was like a step up hill, and then went all the way up at the plateau at the top. And so everybody would kind of come and scrub it and go up, or you jump and land towards the top and then kind of bounce and then out to the top and turn. So I passed Danny around the outside, on this side, and I came over and I scrubbed it. And then as I went down, I was wide open, had my throttle like this. He launched it. He didn't mean to jump on me, but what happened was his front wheel landed on the back of my arm. When it did that, it shoved my hand up on top of my arm, threw me to the ground, and whipped me down. So I got up, and my hand was bleeding and stuff like that. And I looked over. My hand was off to the side. I'm trying to move it. I'm like, oh, shit, it's bad, you know, because it just was hot.
Open fracture?
Obviously. No, it cut my hand, but it wasn't an open fracture. Okay. It wasn't compound, but my bones were up in my hand, and my hand was over here. And I thought I was going like this. It was just kind of jerking to the side. And I looked at him. I took my goggles off. I'm like, what the F are you doing, blah, blah. And so he's like, you went under me. I'm like, blah, blah, you know. And so I never thought Danny did it on purpose. And I never blamed him. It just really bummed me out because he never said sorry.
Oh, yeah?
He never said sorry. And he got a lot of shit from people, you know, that he didn't need to get.
I'll bet he got death threats.
Well,
there were some pretty serious RJ fans.
But, and so, I mean, trust me, I think it hurt my life a little more than his.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was what it was. And I've never talked to him since. And if he was here right now, I'd you know, I would say I'm sorry that if I had some wacko fans that wanted to kill you. And if even if it was my fault, I wouldn't have cared if he said it was my fault. It sucked. You know what I mean? And I, because I landed on Brock one time really hard and went over and said, I'm sorry. You know, I didn't. Last thing I want to do is hurt somebody that I race with.
Think things happen in the heat, in the moment. Not even the heat of the moment, just things happen.
Just, yeah.
You can't anticipate exactly who's going to go where at what time. But like you said, I can actually relate to a situation where someone actually broke my femur and was someone I knew quite well. And, you know, you always expected that day to come up and say, hey, this is what happened. And like, yeah.
So you never
quit
with
that.
Mm-mm. Who is that son of a bitch? Let's call him.
You call
Danny Storm.
And say, hey.
Yeah, this is RJ. I want to talk about Grant. You son of a bitch.
I got something that's my chance for a friend.
That's right. But no, and that's the thing is that you don't want anyone to get hurt. And so if he's listening to this, I apologize of any grief this caused him. It pretty much, and I'm going to say it one time on this show, it fucked my career. Yeah. But honestly, at the end of the day, it made me who I am. You know, I mean, yes, I could have won more championships. Yes, I could have done this. Yes, I could have done that. But I could be, like, you know, I could be in a wheelchair. If he was, and honestly, this is a true story. When I got up, and I was pretty a young Christian at the time, and I got up, and I actually had the peace of mind to say, thank God that he wasn't over this far. Because if he would have hit me in the back of the head that hard, he would have either killed me or paralyzed me.
Yeah.
So to have this, it sucks. Yeah, I don't like it. I tell jokes and it looks funny because my hand doesn't work. And my dance moves.
Your breakdancing's got a shit.
It went to hell.
So I ruined multiple careers in one split second.
But it
a foot to the left and
yeah, foot to the left and foot to the right wouldn't ever happen. Foot to the left, it could have killed me. Mm-hmm. And so it is what it is, and it made me the man that I am, and I wouldn't change anything because of the family that I have and the everything that I've gotten to experience from that.
Yeah, that's crazy, man. I remembered clear as day, I think it was on Moto World, there's a video of you walking through the Gatorback pits, your hand in a sling or in something, and you can tell you're pissed.
Yeah.
I mean, I just, as a kid, you know, you waited for 30 minutes of Moto World. Yeah. And I just remember that video, go, oh, man.
Yeah.
And that was, yeah, it changed your career for sure. So how many years do you think you had if the wrist didn't ever go bad?
Well, and this will transfer into one of the questions that someone had about GPs. And so my plan was, that was my first year of a three-year contract. And so I wanted to do 3 years in America, and then I wanted to go to Europe while I was still young and strong, and I wanted to go win
wow.
500 GPs just to show. Because we had Brad Lackey and Dan Laporte, and then Brock went over there and he was on a KTM at the time, and so it wasn't a real good bike, and so I wanted to go over there and race because I felt I was mature enough. Because when Brock and I first were really young, we would go to Japan and stuff like that. Like, I didn't like the food. I didn't like I was just a typical spoiled kid from California, and I would have crumbled over there. But after going over there every year and testing in Japan, I wanted to finish my career out. And so that was my plan to finish in Europe, but it didn't work out.
Interesting.
Yeah. There was, we got an email from David Bailey, and I thought this was great.
Yeah.
Actually, he posted on Instagram. He says, hey, Rick, remember when we raced 125s at Mammoth and you beat me with a flat tire? He says, that was awesome. Well,
that was in 1982, and so we did all three classes. Uh-huh.
Is this?
No, that's not it.
That's later.
I won all three classes.
Wasn't
that year.
The goal to be? Didn't they call that King of the Mountain?
Yes.
If you won all three classes.
Yeah, and that was in 1990.
Or
1989, I think that was. Yeah, that was 1989 because I had a number two helmet. That was the year I got hurt, and I came back, and I won all three. No, I was not the first. Warren Reed, I think, was the first.
Okay. Jeremy did it after you, I want to
yeah,
say.
Yeah, Jeremy, I think did it.
I don't think he did. I think he won two of the three multiple times.
Scotty Bowen, no.
I won two of the three as well, and I got a flat.
He won two out of three.
Yeah.
My brother Mike won two out of three.
I was going to say, there's been a lot of guys that have done two out of three. I won five out of six motos. And he also tucked the front end in the first turn.
Yeah, that's right. So what happened was Donnie Hansen and I, David and I were talking about this today, that David won the 500 class. And then Donnie Hansen and I did this. And I think it was the best race I've ever had. 45 minutes, we went back and forth, probably passing two to three times a lap. And I've never seen video
contact.
Every time I passed him, pretty much. And then so he would pass enough. Me, and then I would run into him, and I'd pass him and run into him. But I ended up winning the race. And so, and David just said, he goes, I just sat back and watched you guys. But in the 125 race, I don't think I won. I think we both got like fourth or fifth or something like that. But he's trying to catch me. And he thought, oh, I got him. I think he's getting tired, and I had a flat tire. So he finished right behind me. So, yeah, it was Bailey in my career went back and forth quite a bit.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. I love hearing stories from guys that like David that you raced with. So we wanted to ask about GPs. You kind of answered that. Was a guy named Pat Stott, 90s motocross. If you follow him, he really wanted to know that. Let me go this route. And you've mentioned this before. Who, in your opinion, is the best rider of all time?
Well, you got to categorize them in different ways. If you want to just, and I've said this before, if you want to look at sheer numbers, you got to look at Jeremy and Ricky. You know, I mean, they've been there, they've done that. But I honestly believe if you want to just take a moment in time, let's take the best lap, without a doubt, and I'd like to ask some opinions on this, Danny Chandler and James Stewart. Those two guys would do some of the craziest shit.
bit.
I never got to see Magoo ride in person, so it's tough for me. But
well, Brock and I had to race against that crazy son of a bitch, and when he was around you, wasn't he? You weren't worried about him taking you out on purpose. It was just like, oops, and then you know, just like, oh shit, where's he coming from? All over the angles. But like the fact that he went over there and he won motocross and Trophy to Nations the same year, and Brock knows going over to those guys in their backyard, stuff like that, and doing that, and then him at Southwick with the bar that's bent down to here. He's holding on to it like on the
like a speedway,
exactly.
Or like
a... and the throttle was there, and he's just flying. But he couldn't put it together all the time. He would get hurt. Same thing with James Stewart. Like when I would watch James Stewart when I was a riding coach for some of the guys, when what was miraculous is when he won the 125 championship against 250Fs. And that guy, I thought he killed his clutch. Barely ever touched it. His corner speed, his entry speed, he would open everything up and he would rail the corner so much faster than everybody. And he was so confident mentally that he would get top five starts on a 125 against 250Fs. I mean, think about that.
No, it was insane. I was racing against him a little bit at that time. And then
it drove me nuts, too.
It was incredible. Well, listen.
Trust me, I know. The guy was fast.
Was Magoo the same way where you'd watch him ride and you just go, like, how did he just do that? There was a triple, I remember, in Phoenix one year on a 125. It was right out of a turn.
Stu was doing
I think it was 02.
Yeah.
And he would do it from inside, sitting down, and just be flat. And, yeah. I mean, I was to the berm, lifting, you know, and still coming up short.
Right.
And I'm on a factory KTM, and my bike wasn't slow.
Right.
Like you said, just corner speed and momentum. I don't know. He was just magic.
Yeah, and the flow, I would watch him, and there'd be a track. And everybody would be here, and he would come into the corner. He would be 6 inches to the left,
or so, to the right.
Yeah, to the right or whatever. So when he hit the corner, he would take this a half a degree off the corner. So he's turning less than you, and he can go faster than you because if it's a bigger turn, you can go faster and all the different stuff. And a lot of people didn't pick up on it, and Ricky didn't for a long time. Ricky changed. You know, Jeremy would time everything to be smooth and all the different stuff, and then Ricky would come in, slam on the brakes, turn, and then pull the trigger. Because he was a smaller guy. But when you tried that against Chad Reed and a James Stewart that roll the corners and have all of this exit speed. I helped Ricky with two things. One was at Phoenix. We're walking. I said, Ricky, you walk your line. I'm going to walk James's line because his crew didn't want me helping him. And I'm walking. I'm like, where are you pointing? He's like, at section G. I'm like, I'm at section G. And then we go up here. And I'm like, I'm at section H, blah, blah, blah. So anyways, I get to the corner. I'm like, I'm facing out on the exit, and you haven't even turned yet. How can you go through this corner as fast as me? And it sort of changed his way a little bit. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing. Just with this announcing, is that Ricky will figure it out.
Yeah.
You know, he might not be the prettiest. He might not have the most fluid twang to his voice, but he figures shit out quick.
Yeah. Yeah. He'll say words like preparator. He'll make words up. Damn it, he will figure it out, and he will be good.
We'll make him more better.
He'll be more prepared for this Supercross season.
Yeah. Much more better.
So when it comes to that, I guess, you know, you look at guys and say, would he be the best? And where you go, who's the GOAT and the greatest of all times?
I know you take some umbrage with that. You don't like really calling him the GOAT.
Well, yeah, and part of it is my ego that I think I could beat him. And you know what? So does everybody else out there. But we're not going to get to race each other.
Yeah.
We're not. But
different periods are relative to the time.
Could somebody that small ride a bike that where you had to use leverage, like a Joel Robert and a Roger DeCoster, where you had to float stuff? I mean, Ricky's just sheer animal. Now, Joel Robert wasn't. He wasn't in shape, and he didn't want to train, but he was very smooth. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And Bob Hanna and blah, blah, blah. So it goes back and forth. I mean, but sheer numbers, Ricky Carmichael's kicked everyone's ass. I mean, there's no doubt about it. And the way he would adapt in a national would blow my mind.
Yeah.
His line for practice, first moto, second moto, completely different racetrack, but still always the fastest guy.
I felt like I would go, being on a 125, he was 250s dominating, and I'm like, I'm going to go out and, you know, go and have a look and see what lines he was taking. And then I realized sometimes I'm like, I'm taking the exact same lines, but just not nearly as quick as he is. I mean, he came into the corner and was like, yeah. I'm like, geez. Yeah. Like, no throttle control, nothing. But he managed to make it work. He used his clutch as throttle control.
Well, but his body worked for him because he's smaller. You take a guy like a Dogger to drop the hammer like that, or a Mike Bell.
Yeah.
Your body's gonna. You have Can't to use the angles to help you. I guess that's a relative question.
It's a tough question to answer.
Very tough.
Yeah.
And Davey Coombs did a great job, by the way. And I joke saying that he missed it. And I'm honored that he put me number three. And you know, people want to say, oh, if you didn't have the wrist, you would have done this, you would have done that. If Bob Hanna didn't hit the, you know, break his leg water skiing, he would have done this. If Jeremy McGrath, if Honda would have kept that Honda a couple more years, yeah, Jeremy McGrath would have won even more. And the list goes on and on. So I'm grateful for what I got to do.
As I say, if my aunt had balls, it would have been my uncle.
That's right.
Yeah. So we just leave it at that.
Hey,
if I'd have had any championships, I'd have been on that list.
Yeah, right. Yeah, you would have been up there fighting for podiums.
Tell me the best and worst teammate you ever had.
Oh, best obviously is Brock Lover, and I hate to say it. It sounds like I'm blowing so much smoke up. I might get a free set of tires after saying it. But if I could just get three of those posters. But Brock was the best because he was local. He was he helped raise me. You know what I mean? When I was doing something stupid, he wouldn't hesitate to tell me.
Did he ever have to straighten you out? Did you ever get like a little squirrely and he had to? Yeah.
I would probably have to say yes. I can't see Brock.
I can't see
Brock.
Well, so, we'll have to get him on here and we'll ask him.
Well, yeah, I
one
got
of these days.
I'm going to say that in between, you know, like a river trip, I might have gotten a little sideways or down at the desert and he had to say, hey,
No young superstar ever
really?
Does that.
Yeah.
Young Ricky, huh?
Yeah. I have that gene in me. That worst teammate. I would say because he hated me was Bob Hanna. You know,
in the same
time frame, you know, Brock was there and I was racing for Yamaha and Bob and I got into each other in the 1981 Supercross. One of my first ones where I had to just go anyhow. So I get out there, I'm in sixth place, I'm armed, pumped, and breathe, holding my breath. Hanna's coming back, it's a big comeback. He's number 100 and I'm over jumping turns and stuff like that. And he's hitting the back of me, thinks I'm brake checking me, comes by and he kicks my fender, flips me off. I'm like, oh, F you, buddy. Pew, and I hit him. I try to knock him off the track, and then he comes back, passes me, and then there was going to be like a fight in the pit and blah, blah, blah. And so the reason I say that he was the worst teammate is because he didn't like me, and I really didn't like him either. But and also he didn't like Brock.
I think, yeah.
He didn't like anybody, story, yeah. I don't think,
no,
really.
No. And Brock was my friend. So
I think when you look at careers, no matter who it is, there's the alpha male, and then when the next one's coming along, they never like each other.
Tension,
the
course,
one that's passing the sword, or you know, the guard, doesn't like the you know, the next guy coming through. So, I think that makes sense as well.
Yeah, I mean, Mike Kudrowski took me out harder than any other teammate, but that was just was what it was.
He didn't seem like that kind of guy, really.
Yeah, I leaned on him and forced him out a little bit, and then he cut this corner and just blasted me, and so then I was kind of mad and wanted to Duke with them a little bit, but they stopped that. But I was on my way out anyways. I was struggling with my wrist and stuff like that.
Yeah, you were having that
Mike
thing
was
lock?
On the, yeah, well, it would just lock up on me, and they ended up fusing part of it. But, but when I say that Bob was the worst teammate, he was an awesome teammate in a sense of, as you said, the alpha male. I mean, he was the hurricane. He would make these crazy bets. We talked about that he would say like he could run around the track and he'd wear like Bevo's boots and things like that, and just all this crazy stuff that I looked at. But as far as like somebody that he, there was no pulling me in and saying, hey, young,
it
wasn't
young
helping
Rick.
You.
No, he, it there was none of that. Yeah. And Mike, but Mike was also, Mike Bell was also
kind
a
great
teammate.
Kind of like Emig with Carmichael. He's not ringing in. According to what you said. Yeah, he's like, hey, buddy, figure it out yourself.
Hey, go break a leg. Like, really, really break a leg. I need
it's
my
a lot of stairs getting up to that booth.
So, yeah, so I had great teammates, but some of them, like I said, some guys were treating me well and other guys, you know, Johnny and I didn't get along because I came and took his spot. You know,
really?
We didn't hate each other.
To this day?
To this day. No, we're totally good now.
Okay.
You know, but at the time, I mean, yeah, how stoked would you be? You've been at Honda forever, then a guy comes in for 1 year, and then you get fired because you got third. I mean, shit, think
about
that.
It's like you didn't perform.
No, we got first, second, and third in all three championships, and he got third in all of them.
That was Honda's dream.
Was that when he went to Suzuki then, that next year?
Yep.
Yeah.
Ah. Huh.
Awkward silence. Sorry,
speaking of
Sean.
Awkward silence, what's the weirdest thing a fan has ever asked you?
To sleep with his wife.
What?
No.
That's not that weird. I think that's cool.
That's weird to me. That's weird to me. I didn't say I did it. Easy. Pump the brakes, people. But we just had.
You also didn't say you didn't.
I did.
How does one propose that? How does that even happen?
Hey, bro, check out my chick. She thinks you're hot. You want to blah, blah, blah? What? Is your problem? Like, we all sign some boobs and stuff like that. But that's just good, clean fun. but yeah, that was awkward for me. And no, I didn't do it. So I am saying on the record, I did not do it, and it was very, very awkward.
I had a moment one time. I was rookie year Suzuki just getting my feet wet, and I looked up to Guy Cooper. He was the man, right? So the gal he's married, you know, Coop's got his old ladies were
easy,
wild, right?
Right.
Lots of drama that we won't get into, but we're at this after party, and I don't even think I'm 21. I don't even know how I'm in there. And he says, "Hey, Pink, come here, look at this." And this guy's girlfriend, like, "Hey, show him." And he shows her tits to me, pierced nipples and the whole thing, and I'm like, you know, I don't even know if I'd ever seen a pair at that point. And he's like, "Nice, right?" And I'm like, "Yeah, good stuff. Thanks, yeah. Coop."
One was silver. One had a
great story.
One had a turquoise rock on it. You didn't really look at him that much.
Yeah,
yeah. You're like, anyway. Am I at a jewelry store? Yeah. Do I have to pick? Can I have both?
So some weird stuff happens. But no, I did not sleep with the fans. Girlfriend or whatever she was at the time.
It's the first time I'm disappointed in you, actually.
Yeah, I'm sorry. My bad.
Listen,
if I would have won 8 championships, it would be a different story.
Nothing surprises me about what may have been asked of you after seeing Farley Castle. We went to the Vet Motocross the Nations race in Farley Castle over in England this year. Ricky was the guest of honor. I was just there kind of as a floating journalist racing a 125 and writing a story on it. And seeing these people over there in England lose their shit when they saw Ricky. You've not ever seen people freak out like this. I mean, they couldn't even talk. They'd go full, just flush and like giggle and laugh. My wife says, he's like the Justin Bieber of motocross. So that's why I tell him all the time. Hot. He's like the Justin Bieber of motocross.
I'm glad she didn't say I was like the Fat Albert of motocross.
Yeah, you're good, man. You're hip. Tell me about social media. What's your thoughts on it right now? It's obviously a completely different world from when you were racing, but between Instagram and Twitter and Facebook,
it's like it's becoming part of being a racer. Is
it good? Is it bad? Is it?
It's good and bad. I think there's way too much emphasis on it. I think a lot of the stuff now is I loved our time, my time of when I won Honda or Yamaha at an ad agency, and your idea was to get an ad in Cycle News or get this or that. And then when Ricky got the billboard down in Miami from Oakley and things like that, and then you got a commercial or different ads and stuff like that, and you just could focus on being the best that you could be. I think a lot of these guys they spend too much time doing it. You know, they because it's important and it's a status that they need to have. And I don't like it with my own racing because it takes away from my racing. I don't want to come in here and go, "Oh, hey, here's my lap time," when I should be thinking about tire grooving and changing and suspension settings.
So
and
how what to improve that lap time, maybe.
Exactly. And how to make it better in this and that. Some of the guys that I can't believe, like Ken Roczen, that dude is a machine. And because he has to do it, he doesn't have an assistant standing around doing all this different stuff. It's a lot of personal stuff. And be honest with you, I don't want people in my business that much. I like to go do what I want to do. And because we're all idiots. We all do stupid shit. And I like keeping my shit in the closet where it's nice and nobody knows about it. And I can just, and then I can go, "Well, that was bad. That was stupid. I don't need to."
But, thank God nobody knows about that.
But now it's like we're at Unadilla with that whole Puerto Rico thing when the wheels fell off and Travis does a backflip and then the boys are out and they got a little rowdy. And next thing you know, the next morning, all hell breaks loose. You know, and I told Davey, I'm like, "Wait a minute." But back in the day, guys were doing stupid stuff. He's like, "I know, but there wasn't social media. It wasn't on everybody's thing." I'm thinking if I were a team manager or something like that, I would probably hire somebody to do each rider's deal. And you got these trainers or something like that with the money that some of the guys are making, that you have somebody putting up different posts during the day and you say, "Okay, you can add a couple things to it just to get out of it." Because I was listening to, like every other guy out there, listening to Joe Rogan and stuff like that. I think there's too much media and there's too much stuff. Like, I can't, like, put it this way, folks. If you sign up to follow me, that does not give you the right to bust my balls. Bust my balls once and I'm cutting you off. You're done. This is not free speech. This is not USA Today. This is my personal thing. If you don't like what I do, kiss my ass and get off my page.
Yeah.
But don't sit there and oh, you're an asshole. You did this. You did that. Yeah, I did. So what? If you don't like it, then don't follow me.
I agree. So
with that, it hurts writers' feelings when they're booed. So you're on there, and some guys keep cursing you and calling you bad names and blah, blah. You know, sticks and stones. That's bullshit. Words hurt you. And so I don't read that stuff. And that's where if somebody, you know, says, I'm friends with you on Facebook. I'm sorry. I don't read it all the time just because I can't. I can't get emotionally attached to it. And then I feel guilty because I haven't read it and this and that. And I'm like, I just screwed up a third of my workday tweeting and doing. I'm too stupid to tweet. So I do Instagram because I do pictures. But that's the thing. So I think they need to calm down and just be racers. And then also I think that's part of the personality that everybody is very brave and very talkative and stuff as they're texting. But now all of a sudden I watch this press conference today, and I qualified today, and I did this and I did that. They have no personality. You gotta communicate back and forth. So I'm 60% for it and 40% not for it.
Okay.
It's almost like a pendulum thing. You know, it's gone from one extreme, and you almost feel like that point hopefully is going to get to a point where we can get back to just communicating as in,
like, hey, how you doing?
Like looking at people and talking to them? What?
Right, yeah, exactly. What? I got a thing called a phone app. I'm going to give you a number. I'm going to call it, and my voice is going to go through it, and you're going to hear it, and then you're going to talk back.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Crazy idea.
Yeah, a lot of problems. Guys, aren't we just supposed to talk about racing? I'm trying to figure out the world's problems.
We are right now.
Okay, we're going to solve a problem right now.
Yep.
Because I know.
You know.
You used to be a badass breakdancer.
Yes.
And hold on. Yes. Let me go further into this.
Not so much break.
This is per Scott Burnworth as well. You used to carry around a piece of linoleum and perform at a place called Pizza Plus in El Cajon.
That part is stretching it. That's a little too far. I didn't need linoleum.
Hold on.
We've got video. Have you guys ever seen this?
Oh, this is in Japan, yeah.
Yeah, you got this is going to roll into
this
another question.
This is the best
too.
Interview I think I've ever seen, ever.
I hit myself in the head with nunchucks.
Do you like ham?
You like ham? I know. They had a script for me, and I'm like... But my hair was awesome.
So you can answer this.
I hate ham.
That's the whole thing.
What's your hobby besides riding a motorcycle?
Well, I like girls, and I also like surf.
I love
the translator.
No, I will not break dance.
Don't.
No
way.
But for money.
Not for money. Wait,
hold on. A little more money.
More money.
All right, now it's on.
It's on.
Watch this.
No, watch.
He's legit. Watch this.
What?
Dude. Those are some moves. Dude, your body is like 180 at one point. Seriously.
I'm getting hot.
Hold on.
That one move.
It's not over.
I swear, with the back.
It's not over. Watch this. Try to picture any other current pro racer doing this today.
But besides that, I like to run and also bicycle.
Nunchuck. Here it comes.
Could you show me?
Okay, just a little bit, but just for hobby. Just joke.
Nunchuck, you guys,
the money.
Dude, that's legit.
It's nice.
That's legit, right?
I hate him.
I don't know what the whole I hate ham thing was about, but that's what they...
Have you ever gotten over the ham thing? Do you like ham these days?
I love ham. I ate ham at Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
I ate bacon every morning.
It's much easier.
You know?
All right, listen. This video, and I told Donnie when we got you, I said, we've got to find this video. I went hunting for this thing.
He showed me, and I was dying.
I saw this years ago, and I'm like... There's just no one ever been like Rick Johnson. There's no one that would ever do anything like this again.
Yeah.
Name somebody. Nobody.
Ken Roxon would.
No, the best part is there's no way. You roost the shit out of this guy.
I destroyed this guy.
He's so happy to have Ricky Johnson.
Yeah.
Here it comes.
So happy with themselves right now. All right, champ, you go ahead.
They got him on an XR60.
Listen, if you want to watch this whole video, we'll put it up on our website.
Hey, can you get to win? Risk, win, risky.
Risky business.
Ricky and Whiskey me, we get risky. No, when Ricky Russom for the umpteenth time when the guys lay down. So when I'm watching this, I'm laughing because I'm thinking, you're riding for Honda.
Yeah.
It's Japanese. You're in Japan. Telling the guy you hate ham and you love girls. I was just thinking, what is going on at HRC?
This dude just gets rocked.
He wanted to get up before he got lapped for the 17th time. Oh, just destroyed.
All right, so yes. What's different? Well, I mean, what is it going to take to get some people that can bring some color like this?
I don't know. They have to want to be a little bit different, you know, because we had a lot of different personalities. Like, we had Jimmy Weinert, who was just like this crazy dude. Then you had Tripes, who was this other guy. Then you had Hannah. You had Bell, who was like this nice guy, but this cutthroat guy on the track. And you had Brock, who was the golden boy. You know, I mean, you had a lot of polarizing stuff. And now everybody's kind of done. They've kind of all tried to be they're all trying to be the same. They're all trying to be the best version of the same guy. That's my opinion.
They all make vanilla look spicy.
Exactly. So I think the one guy that can possibly mix it up is Plessinger.
I agree.
I think the kid's got a lot of heart. I think he's going to do better on a 450 because he's bigger and taller, and he'll use that. Where you see guys like Cooper Webb try to ride a 450 like a 250, and they're bringing the same throttle response and the same hard hits, and it's just too much. And we had that situation with Blake Baggett as well. We had to change his riding style and stuff to get him more casual on that. But Plessinger's, I like that guy. I had him on a radio show when I was doing the Toyota Escondido show, and that some bitch just rocked out, did a country song straight up a cappella.
Oh, he's doing
it good
on his Instagram. I'm speaking of social media. He's doing these karaoke Fridays or something, and there's like him singing for about 10 minutes.
Right.
He's singing in his truck.
So it goes kind of the trends of trainer guys versus partier guys versus this versus that. But I think when you see the factories work on building stars and not just have, this guy's got a big Twitter following that brings some personality out of him. But right now the season's, they're so long. These guys have no time to take a break. You know, I really think that they need to do like two rounds, take a week off, do two more rounds, take a week off or something like that to give these guys a chance if they twist an ankle or something. But it's just everything. The pressure is over the top.
I think Adam Cincirillo could be another really fun personality if he can keep himself healthy and get to that 450 class and win some races.
Yeah. Well, and that's the thing is he grew so much. I mean, that's the whole other story with him. But I love his personality. He laughs at himself. He seems like a really good kid. I honestly said, hey, how's it going? Got that professional courtesy nod. How's it going? But I've never met him, but I'm a fan as well.
He is a super good kid. All right, so clear this up. The Pizza Plus in El Cajon. Did you perform at the Pizza Plus with a linoleum pad?
No.
Now there's
a difference between performing and just being the best dancer on the dance floor. So you got it's like going to the practice track. Did you win? No, but I was the fastest guy.
Yeah,
but I looked good.
Lap times were phenomenal.
So I've always been a fan. When I was a kid, I watched Soul Train over American Bandstand, and I like the Jackson 5. Pop Lockin' is what it was called back then.
But the movie Breakin'.
Yeah,
that was it.
Yeah,
because I had a piece of cardboard and these shiny parachute pants, and I did a few little.
There you go.
Wasn't that good, but
I wasn't good at the breaking, but the pop locking is what I thought was cool, and I thought the girls liked it, and so I did it. It was one of those things. Same thing with growing the hair the way I did and the clothes you wear. You're trying to impress girls. That was the deal.
I know. Good job. You did it. Who's the toughest competitor you ever raced against?
I had so many throughout my career. You know, when I was a kid, I came onto the scene at 9 years old. I was a kid named Brian Ananachi, and he was like the fastest 9-11 guy, and I had dice with him. And then moving up a little bit, Scott Burnworth and Ed Barone Oaks, he was the king there. And then going into the pro ranks, obviously I had Brock and Hannah and Barnett and Bailey and O'Mara and Ward throughout my whole career. And Lachine too. I mean, Lachine on any given day would stomp a puddle in anybody's ass. So when it came to moto, I would say the two guys that stood out that gave me fits because of the bikes and the time frame and stuff, it was David Bailey, because he was like the boxer, and he was like Muhammad Ali, and I was like Joe Frazier. And then Jeff Ward. What I loved about Jeff and also the air with Brock and the different guys is that if you beat them one weekend, they came back the next week and that much harder. Yeah, yeah. And I don't see that as much. I see a guy like he has a good win streak, and then all of a sudden something happens. He tips over this and that. All of a sudden it takes a while to get him back up to where he needs to be. And David had the. He would just, he'd never made a mistake. And so, like, when I raced him in the 500s, we had the same bikes, and I would just sit there and I'm like, he's not going to make a mistake. And so, I had to try to do stuff that was a little over the top sometimes. And it worked in Supercross and 250, but couldn't do it. And then, Wardy, on the other hand, was there the whole time. Like, he was I remember me mini cycle magazines and looking at pictures of Jeff Ward on this JB Honda and blah, blah, blah. And then I got to race with him, get to know him, and then we became, pretty severe rivals and stuff like that. But then I was also blessed when I left. Motorcycles, getting into trucks, I mean, in cars and stuff. I had this guy, Jerry Gay, who was like the king of El Cajon Speedway, who I had to dice for a championship, and then Rob McCracken and Ivan Stewart in the trucks and racing against those guys now. So when you're on the line and you're lining up with these people, they literally make you want to shit your pants. You're so nervous and it makes you sick, and you're going, I hope I have the formula to beat this person, and they had the formula to beat me before. And same thing with Johnny Greaves and racing with Jeremy back in trucks and stuff like that. But when you're in it, when the gate falls and you go, it becomes a perfect place. And then when you're done, and I appreciate it so much more now. I'm so grateful for those competitors. But so I'm giving you a long answer to a short question, is I've been blessed with unbelievable rivals. But if I had to take the one guy that had my number, was David Bailey.
Yeah. Okay. Wardy was always the guy that I remember.
Yeah.
He's just the era I grew up, 84, 85, 86, you guys, it was like tooth and nail every week.
Well, yeah.
And you were so different too. He was kind of quiet, soft-spoken.
But if you looked at all three of them, their styles, their techniques, the approach, everything was so different. It's so fascinating to see how it played out. You were a little bit of the bulldog. Yeah. Wardy wasn't very polished. He was more like the original RC, kind of short, just use his body. And then David was just, meticulous,
flawless.
just incredible. And I remember it was fun watching that growing up.
So tell us a little bit about the transition you made then into car racing and how that started, truck racing.
So when I got all the way back, I had a fancy for cars, growing up with Brock and Marty Smith had Porsches and stuff like that and cool stuff and sand rails and things. And so I got some go-karts and was having some fun with it. And just, it was a way to kind of keep me going. Then I also thought that I looked at these NASCAR guys that were in their 50s, and I knew that I couldn't race motocross in my 50s, so there would be something that I could transition into. And the people from Bell Helmets at the time put me through a Bondurant driving school, and then I did a Skip Barber race at Del Mar and did some different stuff. But then when I got hurt, I got an opportunity, and I went and interviewed with Chevrolet, and they put me in a stadium truck. And I just said, I can do this. And they're like, how do you know? I'm like, I just know.
Was this Mickey Thompson?
Yeah, this was the Mickey Thompson. And so my idea was to kind of piggyback on what Robbie Gordon did. Robbie Gordon got into off-road trucks, then into Trans Am, then into GTP, and I wanted to get to GTP cars, but they went away. And then I got into stadium trucks and did well. Won some races, did winning championships, got rookie of the year, and then got into some desert racing, won a Baja 500, and did some stuff, and just kind of struggled back and forth. And then when the stadium racing went away, I tried my hand at stock car racing. Things weren't going really good. For me there, I wasn't really getting good opportunities, and so it was pretty much pretty dismal. And then Jimmy Johnson moved back to North Carolina, and so we took all the pots and pans and stuff that we had and everything from our river house and set up his house and stuff like that, because we were looking out for him and kind of took him around. Anyhow, he had one more season on his truck in 98 and said, if you like the way I drive, why don't you hire the guy that taught me? So he returned the favor, got me a ride in the short course truck, and I won the championship. And then I followed him to ASA. I won Rookie of the Year, and then he went on to Busch Grand National, and then they told me I was too old at 35, and so then I was done again.
Wow, and at 35,
At 35, they're just going, so then I didn't get a shot there, so then we moved back to California. I was doing schools and stunts and this and that, and I started doing announcing for Jim Baldwin with the Core Series, and I got his son didn't want to run the one truck, and I almost won the cup race with them, and then that springboarded me back, and then Red Bull picked me up with Barlow, and then we won the Pro 2 Championship, and then Menzies acquired that sponsorship. I went into Pro 4, won the Pro 4 Championship, and helped Jeremy get hooked up with Johnny Greaves, and so we got to dice it with each other in the Pro 2s, and now I'm racing desert trucks with my son Luke. So it's been a dream. In a way, it's been a dream and a nightmare I'll put together, because you know I haven't had the successes and the big wins that I really wanted to have, but I've been a contender, and like I say, I've got guys I'm racing against. I feel the best in the world at what I'm doing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I got to do some off-road truck racing announcing and saw highlights and called a few things, and tell you what, this guy is not hyping himself up like he should. He is an incredible four-wheel drive racer. He taught a lot of these guys the things. Seriously, I'm not saying because he's sitting next to us. There's not been too many guys to go from two wheels to literally get to the top of off-road four-wheel racing. And
thank you.
And Ricky did it on multiple occasions, being the best of the best, in at times maybe not in the best of equipment. And I really think that's a testament to just being an all-around absolute legend of the sport.
Just a racer.
Yeah.
You're a racer. That's the bottom line. Well, that sport seems to me like it's not really a sport where you can go make a living. It's just where you go spend a lot of money,
yeah,
and have a lot of fun.
Duh.
It's expensive.
It's a very expensive sport. And when I started, the other manufacturers in it, but it's all changed. And now there's really not many. I mean, even Jeremy just this year sold his team because you had to, if you want to drive it. And that's the thing. It's so much fun that everybody is a driver owner.
Yeah.
You know, and so I was kind of the last of a dying breed. I drove for Steve Barlow. He was racing Pro 4. I was racing Pro 2. And then when Bryce Menzies came in, I was mentoring him and coaching him. I was Pro 4. He was Pro 2. And then, you know, I did it so long, for a little while. And then it's like, well, why are we spending money on having him? Or let's put Bryce in both of them. So it is.
You taught Bryce pretty well, too.
Yeah, he's a stud. He's an unbelievable driver. But it's afforded me the opportunity to do things that I couldn't afford. So if I won the lotto, you know what I would be doing? Racing trophy
truck racing. Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it does.
Winning
it does,
Baja.
That's the plan. And so if I had to make a choice, you know, it does put a damper on what I can do making money and stuff like that. But it affords me the chance to give me that, let me be that racer. Let me be that 9-year-old kid. Let me be that young guy that wants to go out and just haul ass. Like Ricky Bobby says, I just want to go fast, you know. and with age comes a cage. And so I feel like a kid when I race.
Has anyone ever told you look like Ricky Bobby?
Yeah, I heard that a couple times. Yeah. I was like, you look like Will Ferrell. I'm like, the ugly Will Ferrell or the good looking one? It's kind of a variance.
There's a huge difference.
There is a huge difference. Hey, cowbell.
It's got to be cool getting your son involved and being able to kind of share that passion with him,
yes.
Right? I mean, he didn't obviously take to the motocross thing, but you guys have that truck racing in common and can talk shop, talk racing.
Well, and I'll be honest with you, he had the motocross bug completely.
Did.
And I kiboshed that shit. I didn't want to see it. I didn't want it.
You're like, you'll have more longevity.
All my kids rode, you know. My daughter Cassidy, she rode at 3 years old, and my other kids they rode and raced, and I didn't want them to feel the pressure of it. But Luke wanted to race, and so he started going pretty fast. But then he crashed a mountain bike, broke both of his arms, and that, and so they kind of curbed it. So I'm like, I don't want to see him going through this pain again. You know, I had to be down there with him when they're setting his wrists and stuff, and I'm just like, this is going to be a life of it, because his personality, he's going to push as hard now. My middle son that played lacrosse and stuff, he's more of methodical and stuff. He still loves riding, but he doesn't. That's not his thing.
Yeah.
And but now Luke went through what they call the Fab School. He's building trucks. He's racing trucks, and we're teammates at Team C. He won a Pro 2 Championship back east. Grant got to call some of his races. That was
fun.
Pretty cool. And so he's doing it on his own terms, you know, and a different route than I took.
That's rad.
You know something else that's cool? They got a mutual sponsor.
That's right.
They run the best wheels.
That's right.
The race wheels.
Yes.
Well, that's why he's kicking ass.
That's absolutely.
Yeah. All in genetics.
No broken wheels and losing championships over there, right? Now we've gotten over that part now.
Absolutely not.
Get you some meth wheels.
But
did you say meth wheels?
Yeah.
That's different.
Those will help too.
That was alcohol. No,
that's where it started.
That's
in
right.
A garage somewhere.
And your middle son, what's he doing? Went to college.
Yeah,
playing
he went
lacrosse.
To college. He was a completely different route. He was a bat and ball guy. We remember sitting in the jacuzzi. They're both racing mini bikes, and I said, "Okay, here's the deal. I mean, I might be kind of a prick to make a kid decide at 12 years old, but it was the way I did, the way I raised my kids. So we're all sitting there out having jacuzzi talk. We're having jacuzzi talk. We're talking about this and that. He's like, well, yeah, I like to race a little bit, but I like lacrosse. I said, I'm gonna make it real simple for you. Tomorrow, you have to either go do the race for a championship or a lacrosse game for a championship. Which one do you go to? And he goes, lacrosse game. I go, you're done racing. I said, you can race and have fun as well, all you want, but you're going to have a bike, and you're going to ride and practice with it, and you're going to race. But I said, you just told me that you don't want to. And my dad gave me that ultimatum at a young age. If you want to screw around and party and stay out late and this and that, then you don't want to be a racer. And so – And I like that he went that route because he went to
transparency.
He went to CSU and he won a championship in lacrosse and now he's building giant houses up. You know, he got a construction management degree and he's living his life I love seeing that all three of my kids. You know, my daughter went through interior design school and now she's working for Laird Superfood. She got a job at Red Bull for a little bit, but she didn't like that. So now she's up in Oregon and they're all thriving and driving and doing all their stuff together. So it's awesome that they don't all fall in that hole. But it is very, very special that I get to share what I do with Luke. And now back and forth. He's better when it comes to mechanical stuff and like, oh, Dad, I would do this and do that. You know, he takes my crazy ideas.
I was going to say, I've seen him working on his truck, and I'm like, you're a fabricator. You're a borderline fabricator.
Yeah.
Like,
but that's so
what
cool.
You do to go Pro 2 racing, you know?
Yeah.
You
gotta, for you guys to be able to talk shop like that and share the same passion, that's so rad. Yeah. And I mean, I can only imagine. I got little kids, but, you know, to look back at all your kids, and you've raised them, and they're all successful.
Yeah.
Man.
No,
it's gotta feel great.
That's been the thing is you don't want to raise an asshole, you know. And I'll be honest with you, I've been around some people that you're like, man, they're cool, but man, their kids are tyrants. They just wear me out.
We have people we won't hang out with because kids are no good.
And I imagine people look at the way I've raised my kids and critique it and stuff like that. But I'm extremely proud of what Steph and I have done with the kids and the respect that they have for us and the respect that we have for them. It's been a huge blessing, and because sometimes shit doesn't turn out the way you want.
Yeah, amen.
I think you did a great job.
Yeah, well, you were a dad. It sounds like you made hard decisions and forced them to make hard decisions, which is what a parent needs to do, right?
Yep.
Well, let me ask you this kind of last question. We've been going for a while. When you look back at your whole career, motocross racing, truck racing, car racing, family, what do you want your legacy to be? What are the things that you hope people remember Rick Johnson for?
Well, the French have a word that it's called panache. And it means a lot of things, and there's not a word in the American language for it. And it means style and flair and heart and all of those things, integrity and everything. If a guy has panache, he does it as bad, the best that he can. And I don't... if someone wants to say I'm the best of all time, great. If they want to say I'm fifth, tenth, whatever.
You're third.
I'm third. According to David Coombs.
Thanks. One stat.
Yeah.
Drop the mic.
Yeah. So whatever that opinion is great, but I just want people to look back at my career as a racer and say that he fought hard. That didn't no matter if it was a lap to go or the start or the finish or whatever, that he's going to give it all he's got. And so, you know, you win some, you lose some, and I think that you need to, when you get your ass kicked, you go over and you congratulate. And that's what I love about mixed martial arts is you see these guys, they hate each other, they curse each other, they're like spitting on each other before the fight. But man, when it's over, 99% of them hug each other because they've been tested.
Yeah.
And so for that, and then also with my family, I just want to be known as a good dad that loves his family, and I'm going to finish this. I'm going to try not to get too choked up, but we all have dads, and I lost mine this morning, and he taught me so much. You know, people, Philip Hodge said to me today. He says, "Your mom taught you how to be a lover, and your dad taught you how to be a fighter." And my dad and I fought hard. I mean, we had some really shitty years together, and we didn't like each other over certain times. And I went through a situation with a guy, and I was telling him about my dad, and he says, "God bless him." I said, "Oh, you really don't know my dad. You know, he's kind of a prick." And he's like, "Well, God bless him." I'm like, "You're not hearing me. My dad's a prick." And he says, "No." I said, "But," he says, "he taught you a lot." And he says, "Well," I said, "well, some things I didn't really appreciate or agree with." He says, "God bless him. He taught you those lessons." And so. The week that I got to spend with my dad before he died this morning, I got to clear all that air, up with him. And I'm grateful because there's certain things that he had limited exposure to. You know, his mother and father, the way he was raised, and he did the best that he could. I didn't agree with it, and I changed what I did with my kids as he did with me.
Yeah.
And so for those that have that, you know, and have lost their dads like Bill and stuff, is that don't let a time go away, because I was always never afraid to kiss my dad and tell him I love him. And that's the last thing I got to say to him. So at the end of the day, I'll love you to death or I'll beat the shit out of you.
Yeah.
What do you want to do?
Well, listen, man, you're a product of your parents, period. Yeah, absolutely.
And thank you for coming on. I mean, RJ, yeah, something like that, a lot of people would have just said, hey, man, we're not going to show up. I'm not in the right frame of mind. I mean, I'm tight with my dad, and hearing that story gets me choked up. But we really, really, I think, speaking for everyone, really appreciate you coming out today.
Amen.
Phenomenal.
Thank you. And listen, man, I'll just say this. You are a product of your parents. Yeah. And so you can look at your dad and know that he raised an incredible man.
Yeah. Well, okay. Thank you, man. I appreciate that.
Thanks for coming on.
Thank you for coming out, everybody.
We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back to finish up the show. Welcome back to the Whiskey Throttle Show. What an incredible interview with Ricky, man. Just a genuinely good human being. And
entertaining.
He's entertaining. He's like, he was the whole package, you know?
You know what? It's funny is before I met Ricky Johnson, I was a fan. In fact, I was a big fan of him, Bailey, and Ward. You know, as a kid, those were the first sort of three superstars that I gravitated to, their personalities as well. But once you get to know people, there's certain people you fall more in love with, and others you're like, he was a good rider, but not my kind of. But RJ, he's such a character. I love that guy. Working with him in the booth before has been amazing, and his stories are phenomenal. Like Roger was great, and Roger's got like those very scientific stories and very wholesome. And then with RJ, it's like, let me lay my pad down and show you some moves.
And he held back. There, those house parties, I got him and Glover were chatting after and giggling and like saying, I'm glad you didn't talk about that one. I'm like, come on, man. Let us have it. Anyway, let's get to the Decal Works Last Call Subbing. Decal Works, if you guys are looking for graphics for your bikes, but not just graphics. Graphics, plastics, seat covers, garage mats, accessories, stickers, anything you need printed, these guys can do it. I wonder if it's called Decal Works if you're in Canada.
Yeah, you know, for a Canadian.
I did about it. Decalworks.com. Check those guys out. What an awesome company. Awesome to work with.
And we're going to be working on a Whiskey Throttle graphic.
Yes. Well, it's very early to be talking about this, but we are going to build a Whiskey Throttle Show graphic kit that you can buy for any model of bike. Stay tuned for that. We saw a preliminary drawing, some sketch artwork for it. It looks really rad. And hopefully that'll be available for anybody that wants to buy it down the road. It's in the works. Speaking of Decal Works.
In the Decal Works.
Yes. Okay, so we're going to get to this Decal Works last call. This is a super big RJ fan that's calling about a new bike. So let's have a listen.
Sales department, how can we help you today?
Hey, I need to speak with a salesman. Who am I talking with?
This is Tori. Who am I speaking with?
Tori, what's going on? This is Skippy.
How can I help you today, Skippy?
I'm looking for a dirt bike. You know, I'm a huge Ricky Johnson fan. I've been kind of out of the sport for a long time. I didn't have the money when I was a kid. Huge Rick Johnson fan. And, you know, financially, I just couldn't do it. And I finally now I'm making some cash. I'm making some cheddar. I want a dirt bike, man. I want to go back and, like, get into it, relive my young days. And I want something like my man Ricky Johnson had. I was there watching when he won his 84 championship on a Yamaha. I know you guys sell Yamahas. He won an 86 and 88 on a Honda. Dude was crushing it. Too hip. Dude was too hip. So, you guys sell Hondas or no?
We sure do.
Okay, so you got to talk me through it here, man. I need either something, a Yamaha or a Honda, and you got to RJ me out, man.
Well, best thing to do is come on down and sit on them all. See which one fits you the best. They definitely have some different characteristics on them when you sit on them.
You remember when RJ was going to win that one title and his front wheel blew up right at the end? You remember that?
I don't.
Ah, oh, no. Man, you got to get back on the YouTube and just check it out.
Dude, right on.
Legit.
Right on, man. So when do you want to come down and check them all out?
I can probably come down tomorrow, maybe. Like, maybe two? Two, yeah, no three, problem. One, I don't know.
9 to 7, so anytime's good for me. Just come on in, ask for Tori when you get here, and I'll be happy to show you around.
Well, what are we talking about here? Like, maybe, well, I mean, I like the two-stroke. You got any Honda two-strokes or no?
No, Honda hasn't made a two-stroke in some years. Yamaha still does, though.
Wait, what? Honda doesn't make a two-stroke?
No, sir.
What happened?
It's been about 10 years since they've been in the two-stroke market, sir.
Oh, listen, man, I've been out of the game. You know, I've been chasing that cake, bro.
I hear now you. I got down and we'll get you squared away.
I'm gonna be peeling off ones at you like this, just throwing, making it rain on you. I got some money
there.
Man. All right, but so Yamaha makes the two-stroke, right?
They do. Yamaha and KTM still have the two-strokes.
All right, then Honda can stick it. They want to stick with the bike that got my man there. Just screw them. Let's go for this Yamaha.
Yamaha, the YZs, yeah.
All right. You guys sell. I see these new Yamahas are blue.
Yeah.
But RJ rode a yellow bike. You guys have, is there a way we can kind of like retro it out?
You can go get some old school graphics in there, or you can go get the yellow plastics for it, whatever you want.
Decal Works? I hear those guys, they crush it. I hear. I've been looking. I've been researching. I want to spend my money. And I know they can probably make something, huh? But what about yellow plastic? You give me some of that?
Yeah, that's not a problem.
All right. So bike, yellow plastic. Does JT make, I know RJ was JT back in the day. He was legit. And then he went to Fox. I'm okay with that. We could maybe look at that, but I don't really like that stuff. What are you going to sell me? I need gear. Full line of gear. What do you sell me?
Well, we got everything down here. We got the Troy Lee stuff, Fox.
Bang! Troy Lee. Done. Done and done. That's my guy right there. He painted Ricky's helmets. The Mad Dog. You remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I'm in. I want to ride a Yamaha. It's going to be yellow. You're selling me Chorley Designs gear. Decal Works is going to dial me up with some RJ graphics. What?
Dude. Man, we'll get you all squared away. You'll be leaving here a pro.
Are you as psyched as me right now?
Getting there, man.
All right, listen. What's your name? I got to come down. I'm going to talk to you.
Yeah, my name's Tori.
Tori. Like Pines or like Tori Spelling? Is it with an I?
Like Tori Holt. The Y.
Okay, I don't know that guy. I'm going to write that down, though. All right, Tori, I'm going to see you tomorrow. A lot of cash. I'm going to just start flaking it out on you. Ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. You ever been to a strip club and just throwing money? Bang, bang, right bang, on, bang. Fuck the water. Bring me one. Boom, boom, boom. $1 bills. Going to the live stage. It's Mercedes. What? All right. I'll see you tomorrow, 1 o'clock. See ya.
And we're back. All right.
Good times.
Anyway, that guy was a wingnut. All right. Four Wheel Parts. Get at me Q&A segment. Four Wheel Parts is your one-stop shop for everything truck and off-road related. Check them out at fourwheelparts.com. These guys have absolutely anything you need for your truck, van, Jeep, SUV, UTV, whatever you've got that you take off-road. These guys have everything for it, including Method race wheels,
Dunlop
tires. So a lot of synergy there, if you will, with those guys. So check them out, fourwheelparts.com. So we've got a few questions here from people on our Twitter. Do you want to give them our Twitter handle in case they want to send us questions?
Oh, jeez.
Go ahead.
You're
going to
go over that again. Huh?
It's the.
You need an Atticus and a some type of whiteboard to write it down?
Why do you get me when I'm off? Not prepared yet.
At W underscore throttle underscore show.
Yeah.
Very simple. Very, very
simple.
I
thought it was going to be up there, Donnie.
Yeah. Oh,
making me look bad.
Yeah.
Come on, Donnie.
Yeah,
you know me and spelling and all stuff.
It's guy gets one East struggle. Coast 250 championship and he's over there slacking.
Well, I felt like it came really easy to me.
it did.
It kind of did.
You know, it's like, it's the easiest championship I've ever received.
You didn't have to work for it. I appreciate it.
It felt like I didn't get my heart rate to 200.
No, you didn't.
It's fine.
All right.
Oh, so all the questions we asked for before the show have been rapid fire coming through during the show. So we have a lot of good questions, maybe not for RJ, but next time we'll just roll them into someone else. But thanks for all the good questions, folks.
We do have questions. It didn't work out. If you want to get a question on the show for Grant or myself,
later. Or our guest, even.
Yeah, or the guest. Go to our Twitter account, at W underscore throttle underscore show. Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
W underscore throttle underscore show.
Or Instagram at Whiskey Throttle Show. You can send us questions either way. All right, Donnie, what do we got tonight?
Well, we got from BD25MX. He wants to know who each of your favorite competitors were and most hated rival.
So, best and worst?
Best and worst.
Hmm. For me, it's quick and easy. Pastrana was the best because it was hard to hate him. Like, you could hit him and... he'd hit you and after his beating, he'd be like, that was awesome with his bent thumb. And you're like, yeah, I guess it was. Let's do it again. And I would say for me, the worst rival, I'm trying to think of someone that's relative. You know, you always have the one or two as kids growing up. But I would say as a professional, the only reason I'd say the worst was because I felt like we battled multiple years from Europe to the U.S., but it'd probably be Mike Brown.
Hmm.
He was a real pain in my ass.
Yeah. Took a lot of money out of your pocket when you.
Was there a time that you guys got heated or anything?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Off the track.
Yeah, we got pulled apart several times.
Yeah.
Brown had him by the mouthpiece of his helmet, and I was shoving my finger in his goggle strap. And I forget the exact wording, but there was several four-letter words involved.
Did it look like the bubble over Batman when he punches somebody?
I hope so. Because if I punched him, there would have been a bubble over his head.
He's a scrapper. We got to have Brownie on the show. Well, then I can just rip.
He's
YouTube
a scrapper, too. But I feel like when he takes his helmet off, then he comes back to, oh man, it's cool.
He's
super that mellow. Soft-spoken person, but with a helmet on, he was a prick.
Yeah, I you know what? I had a lot of different guys. I think my worst would have to be Greg Schnell. He blew me out of a turn one year at Anaheim when I was leading, and I should have won that race.
Yeah,
and he killed me, and. I don't know. You know, it's all water under the bridge. I'm not mad at
him. I battled with him when I first came in. I remember
he was
thinking
good. He was a really good rider.
And he was also just good enough to be a pain in your ass.
Yes.
Like, if he didn't want you to do well, he made sure you knew about it.
Yeah. I don't know. Best one, probably Kevin Windham. He was just so clean.
Yeah.
You wanted to hate him, but you couldn't. He'd pass you, like, around the outside and not touch you. So, I don't know.
I didn't even realize you guys were on the track at the same time.
Oh, thanks. Well, he was half a lap ahead.
Oh, that's okay. All right.
We had a couple seasons where I was actually close.
Okay, good.
Cross each other on straightaways.
Yeah, I'd see him
next lane over.
When he'd lap me, he'd come around. He was very clean.
You could see him on the next lane.
Yeah, high five.
You know, you guys are very mean to me. I'm going to quit this job. I have two other jobs. I don't need this one. I will quit.
For a multi-time champ with multi jobs, he doesn't need this shit. Okay?
I've got two titles. You think I need this shit?
Yeah. Supermoto and West Coast.
We can all quit.
I want everything I want to win.
Yeah.
All right. What else you got?
All right, from Brian at KTM for Life, 1011.
I wonder what he rides.
Yeah, don't know. He wants to know what you guys think of the Brock Tickle-Wada situation.
Well, I'll say this. Let me go on this.
There's
first.
Been a lot of wada about this.
But here's what I say: if you cheat, you deserve whatever you get, right?
Like, for sure.
It is what it is. The rules are laid out very clearly at the beginning. I don't buy that it was in a damn sports drink. He bought a tainted bottle of Gatorade or whatever the hell he's trying to say. Bullshit. You took something that you shouldn't take and you got caught. So I have absolutely zero sympathy for that. However, I think the way that WADA has handled it is complete chicken shit. It's been however many, almost a year now, and he doesn't even have any kind of suspension written out, like nothing. They've done nothing. And for them to put his career on hold like that is lame.
It's not even on hold.
It's just limbo. It's just nothing.
It's borderline over at this point. I mean, unless there's some clarification pretty quick, I think it's over. I mean, who's going to – let's just say they say, okay, you can come back in sometime 2020. Who's gonna hire him?
How about James Stewart? Where's that at?
Well
– he's also in limbo. He's –
is Scotty Bell's asking about James Stewart.
Hey, we're in 2019.
I think that ship has sailed, buddy. Yeah, that ship has sailed. He's not going to come back. Well, he took Adderall. He got banned for. He took them a long time for that. He did his suspension. He came back and he was, I don't know, 10, 15 pounds overweight. He had one more concussion. And that was the end of it. But they've screwed this up a few times. Cade Clayson, who's much more unknown privateer, kind of the same thing. They just are not. They put no emphasis on getting it done quickly, or issuing whatever your suspension is going to be quickly.
Well, even just some transparency so people can understand, like. This is what it was, or this is where it came from, this is why we do this. It just seems like, oh, there was something that is not in our, you know, it's not legal in our books. Okay, cool. How bad was it? What was he gaining out of it? When can he come back? Is there a chance to challenge this? Is there a reduced sentence for better behavior? I don't know, but it just seems like he's been locked in solidarity, like in a cell by himself.
You think he should be wearing an ankle bracelet? Is that what you're saying?
He should be picking up trash on the side of the freeway for a month, and then he can come back at San Diego round. I think that sounds fair.
And then we can get on the social feed.
I can have him pull some weeds in my backyard. We'll get him back going for A2, a couple weeks. I'll tell you this. WADA came out to a press conference earlier last week. They made this whole spiel, tried to play nice, talk about how they're you know, new and improved, and they're really upfront and whatever. Not a mention of Brock Tickle. I don't know how you do that. I don't know how you even show your face and not bring that up and say, well, here's what's going on with it, or here's where we're at with it. So just complete chicken shit. Those guys need to get it together.
Throwing the baby out with the bathwater.
Well, they need to just make people understand what they're doing. You know, we all cried for...
Let me say this. This is a little tinfoil hat-ish, but let me throw this out there. Everyone that WADA has busted has been a Supercross American racer, right?
Yeah.
There's no one in the GPs, right? Yeah. WADA is, FIM's organization over there.
Yep.
Does that seem a little suspicious? Are they maybe trying to make an underhanded point that all these American racers are dirty, and there's mass drug use over here in the States?
I never thought
but
of that.
The GP racers are super clean, and look at how great they are. That's the best series in the world. It's conspiracy theorish, but that's not a word. I'm going to go with it anyway. Theorish, but anyway.
I don't know the scene behind it well enough, but like I know.
I don't even. I just like to talk about it. Make, stir things up.
And it could be. Rumors. I mean, I really think, we could go on and on, but there's people that have not cheated for many years that, they found they cheated. And then in other instances, there's people that they said, you're a cheater. And the person said, what did I do? Or what was it? Or how can we fix this? And it's just crickets.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I do find it a little odd.
It's odd. Thank you for the letter. What else we got?
Hey, how about from me?
Pass.
No. Yeah. Hard
pass.
No, you got to listen to this.
A letter from the East Coast champ. We got to listen.
Yeah, East Coast. Is that an East Coast champ?
Oh, yeah. East Coast tracks better than the West Coast. Yeah, no,
we got more rutted tracks. It's fine. So you guys have both lined up at A1 for your first time. What did you feel like the night before and the day of your first Anaheim 1?
Diarrhea. I remember being so nervous. I remember being so nervous, even years into my career at A1, down in the tunnel as the lights go off and the fireworks, you're so nervous. I've said to myself, what am I doing? Like, what this? I'm making myself miserable. You know, like, why do I do this? And then, the heat race gets out of the way and you get racing a couple rounds in and it's all good. But it's terrible. It is awful. Those nerves are so bad. It's kind of, Ricky even said earlier, you're just so balled up on the line. And then once the gate drops, you kind of click into race mode. But, man, I don't envy those guys tonight trying to sleep.
No, I mean, I was genuinely shit scared. And you're talking about the lights in the tunnel. I remember Friday they would have practice, but they would always have the whoop pad, not the whoops. And I remember I felt pretty good and, you know, getting used to the supercross thing. And then Saturday morning, get to the track. And I remember A1, they built a set of whoops. And I remember they were just, in my opinion, they were freaking massive. And I was like, I am shit scared. Like, these are the biggest whoops I've ever seen. And I have zero confidence. And I, at the KTM track, I think they just toned everything down so we'd feel better about ourselves. And I was like, I don't even know. And I started questioning the PDS and this. And I remember I pulled over. And my dad was having a meltdown because now it's time qualifying. And I'm pulling off and I'm watching everyone blitz the whoops. Because I'm like, they're pretty gnarly. And you came through and you look good. And I'm like, wow, the KTM with no linkage can do it. And I tried, and I remember I think I was so stiff, I was so out of control, and I killed it everywhere, and I was so bad there. And you talk about the lights and tunnel. I was walking down the lights and tunnel going, fuck, those whoops are there. Dang it. Hopefully. Take the skiddy and just go across the top and, you know, make me feel a bit better. But
the track was better when that pad was flat.
But I had this sort of feeling like, you know, coming from Europe and winning the world championship, a certain amount of pressure to perform. And I wasn't thinking of which line I was going to take through the whoops. I was like, oh my God, I have to go through these damn whoops. Like, I was so scared. I'd never seen whoops like that. And thank God it wore main line down. But if a lapper was in there in the main event, I was like, hurry up, bro, because I need the same little go trail down the middle because I am not venturing to the highlight. So
you know when you should have been scared? Riding that KTM 252 stroke.
Yeah, well, at that point,
that was like a death catapult.
At that point, I was going through the whoops like this.
I saw him bounce on the concrete once on that 250.
Oh, yeah.
Once?
Yeah. Once? Yeah, you didn't watch a lot of those
once
races,
a weekend.
I didn't want to make you feel that bad.
Thanks, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah, good luck to those guys this weekend.
Yeah.
Well, they have a linkage.
Yeah, that is better.
You mean all those guys?
I just mean all those guys.
Okay, yeah.
what else you got? One last question is, how would you guys prep for a mud race? It looks like tomorrow might be a mudder.
Oh, guy sucks so bad in the mud. I just give up, really. I mean, right, you know. It took the pressure off for me because I'm like, well, I'm not going to do good now. So I was less nervous. I would be less nervous because I knew I wasn't going to do well.
And you probably did better.
No.
Oh.
Not if it was really muddy. No. No, not at all.
I was trying to make you feel
good. I was the worst mud rider.
GL thinks he was.
No. No. It's not even on the same level.
I think Europe helped me a little bit. When I got to Europe, it was really bad.
You were probably a bad mud rider for European standards, which is still
no, I was
a
bad,
great
period. And then I just became a bad-ish European mud rider, which meant I was kind of average on the world level. You know, the problem is at this point, there's not much you can do. You know, a lot of it's in the head. So as a rider, you got to go to your mechanic and your team or your vice versa, and you work together and go, what are we going to do? Maybe we put some foam here. Maybe one tooth big on the rear. Maybe
stiffen the suspension
exactly,
a little bit.
Change the settings. You do things that you think in your head are going to make a better difference, but you can't go and go to the test track and now test in the mud and change everything. So, I mean, for the most part, you are where you're at. Everyone's going to show up going, oh, I haven't really done much mud testing on the new bike. So I feel like it's the great equalizer, that old saying, focus on the start. Mm. Get a good start and don't fuck up.
I could do that, and then I'd just go backwards.
Yeah, but that's what
you fucked
up. It
didn't help me. It says, yeah, yeah. Don't go backwards. Go be better. Don't suck so much.
Be mo better.
Suck less.
That's all we got.
That's all right. It. That is your 4 Wheel Parts Get At Me Q&A. Thanks to all those folks who sent in questions. Again, get us questions for next week. You can be on the show. What an honor. That's it, guys. We're going to wrap it up. I want to thank our sponsors. We've got some awesome people involved with this show. PowerDot, thanks so much to those guys. PowerDot.com/WhiskeyThrottle. Go there and get yourself signed up to win a PowerDot unit. If you just don't want to wait to win, you want to buy one, that code gets you 20% off. So go there and buy one. You won't believe how rad these things are. I mean,
it's the one thing you didn't know you needed until you have one.
I'm telling you, low back, my knees, forearms for arm pump. These things are incredible. It's really a game changer. Super good product. Method Race Wheels, thanks so much to those guys. Awesome products. Method Race Wheels, check them out. Troy Lee Designs, I really want to thank Troy and the guys. I think you already took off, but so stoked that they got involved with this show. Gave us this saloon here to come in and set up our studio, and I love their support. Check out their new line of gear. They've got new stuff coming out. You're going to see here in the next couple weeks. It's incredible. An SE4 helmet, which we're going to do a show about this down the road, just helmet safety in general. The SE4 Carbon, the safest helmet in the sport. I've seen third-party testing. I can tell you firsthand, it is the best-performing helmet, period. Decal Works, go to decalworks.com. Check those guys out. Dunlop. Like I said earlier, support the guys that support the sport. Dunlop has this sport's back 100%, so support them and buy their tires. I also want to mention Paleo Ranch Foods, Langston Motorsports. If you're looking for good high-quality foods or a dirt bike or street bike or...
Or UTV or UTV. Method Wheels or Dunlop Tires.
Yeah, get them in Langston Motorsports.
Or Troy Lee Gear.
Yeah, we've got it all.
I'm just saying, throw my name out. You'll get a 20% off discount too.
Hey, can I get 20% off down there?
Oh, dude, you get more than that. Don't come here and act like you're a poor peasant over there.
Get at us. Follow us on Instagram, at WhiskeyThrottleShow.com, Twitter.
Or Twitter, which is at W_Throttle, with two T's, one L, _show.
God, this is the worst. Wow. What kind of asshole would put together a Twitter handle like that? If you want to send us a question via email, info@thewhiskeythrottleshow.com, you can go to our website, thewhiskeythrottleshow.com, and check us out there. Thank you guys very much. Donnie, thanks for your help tonight, buddy.
Yeah,
appreciate it.
Yep.
For everybody that came to the show tonight, the first live show, thanks so much. Thank you to Ricky Johnson. GL, thank you, my man. We will see you guys next week. We've got Bones Bacon from Pro Circuit. This guy's never done an interview. You're going to hear from him next week. See you next week.